start recording. Hey, we're going to do some Burbit information, half orc guy. Anyways, you'll determine him. This is Shadowy's character for my game. Note session, you know how it is. Boppity boopy, boopy boppy boop a bop. Anyways, hey Shadowy, say hi to the camera.
Hello. I'm here of my own free will. I don't have a gun pointed at my head at all.
So
please,
once
help
again,
me.
Let's begin. As we descend, hold up. I need to put some music on. Yeah, I need some music. Yeah! Music time. Music time. Slash play. Paste, boom. Moonbow card down. Alright, so. I'm going to do slash clear Q and then replay the music here. Q slash play, paste, enter. There we go. So, once again, we enter the realm of Taram, a world plagued by fog, war, time, and forgettance. As well as undeath. However, unlike the eastern part of the world where we usually set ourselves, we fly to the west, past the mountainous and somewhat ashen-filled skies of the Kenku homeland of the continent of Kentu. We see the harpy-styled Kenku bird relatives to the Kenku flying around their large palace in the mountains. As we continue past, we continue westward, past the center continent of... Demosnen, the demon continent, long since plagued by ash and dead... the undead, said to have been the house of the tower of a sealed demon lord of long ago. Continue, western, towards a blackened area in the peaceful sea known as Death's Door, as the waves chop and chop as shipwrecks line the bottom of the ocean floor. We head northwards to a continent above the sea, filled with large cliffs and bluffs, forests, some of which peek out of the large misty veil that surrounds most of this continent itself, small islands floating in the water as well as in the sky surrounding this continent of magic and color. As we continue through, we see a tree on the easternmost reaches of this continent, towering into the heavens past the clouds themselves. And this is where we find ourselves headed. Deeper, towards the tree, towards it. To this large, sprawling, outside area plains. Outside of the city that we see floating around this tree. The many standing stones around this thousands of feet wide lake. In the middle of it, an island where the base of the tree roots itself. These stone obelisks, 25 feet tall, with small cuts at the very top that seem to leave an inch of the center of the stone and then continue back up to a almost, how should I say, a concave-like shape. Ethereal chains that glisten in the moonlight on this moonlit night. As we see the wind blowing past the bottoms of these islands that float and are held aloft by trees as well, glistening with bluish-white light as we see these starlight expanse upon its rock. Similar to the night sky we can see above, this is floatstone, a material used to keep rocks and other islands afloat around this area. We feel the cold air of the waning months of winter as the end of the year approaches. And the complete celestial solstice is nigh. Unknown by many, but many mages prepare in this time. We find ourselves upwards, 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 past the sprawling landscape of the outskirts of the city, towards the western gates. In, past the cobbled streets, not really cobbled, but what actually would be cobbled streets, and the 3-foot by 3-foot tiled floors of the western gates, past the markets, into a small bridge that leads further into the town, as we see walking towards a small mage's tower, heading westward towards the western gate where the mage's tower nearly exists. An individual, a half-orc, if you would like to describe your character for me, as you have just gotten done shopping for some items in town before heading to where you were told to go.
Okay.
You've also purchased a room in the Mage's Respite, by the way, but go ahead.
So, walking down the street of the magical of this magic city is a very short green man. While his features are very similar to that of a human, the green skin that's been mentioned, it makes it quite obvious he's of a different breed. His hair is a orangish red, and his eyes a deep dark blue. This diminutive warrior, wearing nothing but recently sewn together clothes with a breastplate, a bastard sword resting in its scabbard, as he jauntily walks towards his destination. He looks quite young, and his hair is pretty unstyled. It looks as if he's just got out of bed and didn't bother to do anything with it.
As you head towards your destination, the Mage's Respite, night falls upon this city, as the shaded areas of the tree that it sprouts up into the middle of the city, leaving a small 30-foot gap between its trunk and the actual city itself, as the tree branches seem to go across parts of the city, holding it up as the flipstone does as well, being incorporated into some of the designs of bridges and walkways itself. The shade is... Once again, as I was trying to mention, the shade is overtaken by the night sky's darkness, as we see some clouds in the sky. However, the lights of the stars twinkling and the ever-present aurora borealis, similar magical type of phenomenon above the area that we could see in the sky of purples, greens, and blues, glows, giving an ambient light to this city of mage towers rising up. We see buildings sprawled out across this area. We see elves, dwarves, a few automaton, and a few humans, as well as demi-humans walking around the city. We see individuals flying in bubbles, as well as being pulled on carts, pulled by Pegasus in the sky, all lit by lights of lantern lights or other lantern lights that is not fire, but moss or crystal stones. We see the roads have these lanterns that have the same moss-based lights. We see floating fey lights falling from the tree and other places that seem to bounce around the city and also fall off of the city's edges. We see, as you pass over one of these bridges, a small aqueduct that seems to bring the water from one island to another, raising it up with some anti-gravity magic to a small river on another island. It also pours off the side in a waterfall. As you continue through the market, you pass by a group of individual men that are drunk. They seem to be talking about the Flower District, the Red Light District, whatever they want to call it, to the east. It seems to be opening soon. As you continue to walk towards the Mage's Tower, near the entrance of the western part of the city, you begin to walk past and actually bump into a group of individual females that seem to be in this lewdish kind of attire. Well, no, not lewdish attire. These females that seem to be in these kimono-like attires or robes, showing a little bit of skin, and this other individual that's cloaked in a similar kimono underneath. The individual looks towards you as they bump into you and goes, "Are you looking for a partner for the night, dear? One of these lovely ladies could help you."
So Vermin's gonna look over to them, and actually, how attractive are they, actually?
There are two dark elves, which are just dark-skinned elves. They're not drow in this world. They are also known as dark elves, but they're, like, an actual, like, kind of monster race. But there are two dark elves, there is a single drow, and then there are two elves and a human. They are decently attractive, more than a normal elf would be. They seem to have this makeup on, this blush. They are, from what you could tell, definitely members of either a brothel or prostitutes. So they need to look nice.
Yeah.
And they don't look raunchy as hell. They are not wearing, like, lingerie, dancing with, like, flower dresses on. They are actually wearing, like, proper robed kimonos and stuff like that. You see, as you're looking at this and they're waiting for you to respond, a drunk individual walks up to them and goes, "I'll take one for the night." And she goes, "Thank you for your business. That'll be 5 gold pieces. And the individual goes, "All right." And one of the ladies, one of the dark elves, goes off with him down a street corner towards an inn.
Well, ma'am, judging by the price, I don't think I can afford that. But
well,
I wish you a good night.
Well, if you're looking for cheaper services, you could come to the brothel and rent an inn, rent a room and a lady as well for cheaper. If you're looking for someone, it's in the Flower District, a place called Sakura's Blessing. You'll find us easily. And she hands you a small business card. As you look down at it, it has 3 stamp marks, and it has a Sakura flower in the middle of it, that seems to glow with magic. And you're looking at it, and it has 3 stamps. And on the card, written in common, it says, "Get a stamp for each use. After your 3rd use, you get a free night."
Huh. Neat. Well, yeah, I appreciate good customer service. I'll be seeing you guys later.
Oh, I hope you do, dearie. See you later.
Alright.
I will say, make a perception check for me.
Oh wait, there we go. Let's just get the rolls. And, oops. Well, that's a 7.
You could tell that this is, like, not... The woman who was cloaked was not a woman who was going to give you the night with herself. She's
yeah,
just,
she
like,
isn't
the caretaker, the proprietor of this group right here. So she looked. You look over to her, and she has a very
Wait, how many minutes are we into the video?
You are 13 minutes. Why?
So she a pimp.
Something like that. She has a very beautiful, slender face with a smallish nose. And you swear you almost see, like, whiskers on her face, but they seem to blend in quite a bit. You can't make any other details out about her.
Yeah, I kind of was in a hurry to get to where I was going.
You continue to walk past, and you eventually get into the mage's respite, where you see... Fuck it, is her name Lieta? I'm just going to call her Lieta for this time. I don't know what it's actually. I'll put it in NPC's channel when I'm done. Because I need to go over a 6-hour video to look for it.
Oh, boy.
Anyways, so, as you walk into the Mage's Respite, so this small Mage's Tower made of stone that goes up maybe a good few hundred feet and then ends with this capped balcony of red color. You walk into the front door and you see the west and southern part of this room is a bar. It seems to curve around the area of the actual tower. The eastern part is a start of a staircase that goes up and curls around a small pillar in the center of the tower itself. And then the northern side is completely blocked off by a bar that separates the east and the north. And then maybe 5, 10 feet behind the bar, the thing that blocks it off is a doorway and a wall that has an opaque window on it. So, like, you could see that there's people moving behind it with the light, if the light's on, but you can't really see who's behind it. and you figured that's a kitchen slash storage room behind there. You see many different tables and people sitting at them, smoking these cigars that seem to not actually blow smoke out. As you smell, you're not sure what kind of cigars they are, because they smell of different reagents and whatnot. Actually, I'll have you make an Arcana check for me, as you smell these different lavender and other... Actually, lavender and lemon scents at the moment.
That's Arcana. That would be a plot. That's an intelligence-based skill, so let's just roll that. Alright, yeah, that's I don't know. Yeah, right now, Verbit's not very sure of arcane things. He isn't the master of that.
Sorry.
This is very in character for him.
Anyways, I'm just letting the one who created these know. sorry, I'm getting a few messages. So, man, I've had like 3 sessions today. Gosh.
Oh, boy.
Anyways, it's fine. I'm used to it. So, as you smell, you're not sure where these cigars are from, but you can tell they have this magical effect to them as you see somebody brings it up, and you see this arcane seal on it, and he pumps some mana into it and just starts to smoke it. And you can see the cigar itself burns away with this arcanic blue kind of ring of flame. And as it does, this pink smoke comes out of it. And you see his form suddenly starts to shift a little bit, and he turns into a different form as he stands up into the middle of where the bar area is, where there's just this missing amount of tables, and you can see other people get up and perform like little magic tricks, and he starts to perform a play where he smokes a cigar and turns into a different individual looking character, and he continues to do this one-man play, basically. As this happens, you see tending the bar where there's a few individuals sat, this 6'8" crouched over, but as she starts to, this 6'8" orcish looking individual standing behind the bar, she has this almost French maid outfit. However, the back of it is brown instead of black, and the front of it's the apron is a lavender kind of white color, and it has a few spots on it where beer has been spilt or whatnot. You can see as she's standing there 6'8" as she's crouching over, she has these minotaur like bull horns that come out of her out of the top of her head, and you can see this tail that's whipping around behind her as it whips towards a cup that's that's about to fall off the bar, grabs it, puts it behind her as she grabs a few other things, pours some drinks for other people. As she's sitting there, you can see that she is very thick and strong looking. She looks like a full-blooded orc mixed with a minotaur to an extent. And you, now that you're looking at her, she moves around, and as you continue to walk up to the bar for a second, you see the back of her legs look like minotaur legs. However, they don't have fur. They are just green-skinned like orcs. Hmm. Her entire body is just a green-skinned orc, but similar to minotaur kind of fashion styles for her body. You see on her horns around the very top of them capped are these golden caps. Upon her tusks coming out of her mouth, which are pretty large, they're almost bending back into her eyeballs, like they're just beneath her eyeballs. You can see two rings placed upon, one upon the very base of her tusks where they meet her lips, and then maybe an inch up from, not an inch, it would be about half an inch up from that would be another set of golden rings, one on each tusk. She seems to be currently serving drinks to people at the bar as you walk in. You know this person as, I'm just going to call her Lietta for this moment because I forget what I named her, because I didn't put her in NPCs because she was the only NPC I didn't write down. Fuck.
Okay, so I guess I saw Lietta before when coming into the Mage's Respite.
No, because in Mage's Respite you would have come in during the day to procure a room, and she is only a night worker. You would have met her father. You would have met her father, Bill, who would have mentioned her name. Bill is a very stout-looking Greek man, but he's not human. He is a full-blooded orc that looks like a stout Greek man, like deli owner or butcher. So, like, he has that apron. He's pretty fat. He has hairy-ass arms. He's balding a little bit in the middle of his head. And he has, like, this very nice mustache that seems to be very bushy and coked down to his jaw. And he has many rings and necklaces on. He looks like he wears a wife beater and roots for, like, Greece in the World Cup. But yeah, you would have met him. He would have mentioned Lieta, as well as Morgan, their his surrogate son, to an extent, that he kind of got into a fight recently with, and asked if you do see him, to tell him to come back around because they wanna make up with him.
All right.
Which you haven't seen Morgan around. Anyways, as you walk up, Lieta looks over to you. Oh, hey, dear. My Papa Bill told me you'd be coming back soon. What can I get for you?
I'm thinking I might want to try to stay somewhat awake just in case something, or at least sober, just in case something happens. It's kind of weird here.
All right, okay.
So I guess I'll just go with something healthy.
I'll get you some milk then.
That'll be good.
She starts to pull out the carton and goes, so, what were you doing today?
Well, I mainly just went shopping. I'm getting ready to go to some place. It was Oakage, I think it was called.
Well, that you haven't. Jesus fucking Christ! Listen to me, please. When I explain what's going on, we are not there yet. Your character hasn't spoken to Oyez yet.
Oh yeah, makes sense. I think I'm gonna go speak to someone in the city. I've got a job. I'm getting ready for.
Well, dear, I hope your job goes well. And she hands you your glass of milk, takes a silver piece for it.
All right.
Anyways, if you're looking for a fun place to visit while you're here, I'd recommend the Palace Gardens. They're just outside the palace entrance, but it's a very well-decorated and well-maintained area. Of course, you might want to clean yourself up a little bit, and you look down at yourself with a few, like, tattered parts of your clothing. If you're looking for some new clothing, you could always go to, I'm gonna look at my notes here, let's see here, Taylor's Accessories, T-A-Y-L-O-R apostrophe S, accessories. They do some tailoring as well as, sell some accessories like necklaces. I got these golden caps for my horns here from... Anyways, I'm gonna get going to help serve some more people. If you need anything, let me know.
Alright.
She goes. Mind you, her voice isn't exactly like that. It's more southern, but it's an orcish kind of voice. So it's female orc southern. So I can't really do that, so I'm just gonna do that for her voice right now.
Yeah.
For her voice, I'm talking like this, and that's not a good voice. Anyways. As you sit at the bar and drink, roll me a perception check. Perception is just based on wisdom.
That's all I'm just doing yet. Boop. Alright, that's a 19.
Alright, so as you're sitting there,
Drinking milk.
You listen to some conversations. You hear somebody say, did you hear Morgan has a job for us? We should talk to him about it soon. You hear another individual go, really? That really happened? Down in Oakage? Man, that sucks. Hope someone will talk to the guards about it. Did you hear another conversation? Did you hear Madame Leodel talking about implementing some firearms from Darath into the military? Oh, I didn't hear about that. Yeah, it seems they're very well, they're a very good weapon to use as long as you know how to use them, and they're much better than crossbows and bows. You know, I could never understand humans and their want to move faster with their inventing. I know, right? I mean, after all, why would a race that's so young-lived want to move faster and invent faster so they could do more things in their life. It's not like that makes any sense. Oh, fuck you, Jerry. You hear some more conversation going on, and then you hear what other conversation? You see, you just glance and you see this cloaked individual, a noble looking individual, sit down, and you see a cloaked figure walk up to him. The noble noble looking figure, I'll say. He's a fancy looking figure. He seems to be cloaked in. You can't really tell anything about his face. It almost shifts every time you try to make a detail out. So you just glance and listen from a distance, and you hear, Jim, how long is it going to take your men to complete their job for me? Listen, listen, sir. Oakage is a very complicated place to raid. There are many threats around it at the moment. I do not care about these stupid, inconsistent threats. I need you and your men to get your job done. I am not paying you to sit on your asses. Listen, listen. Craig says we will invade them in the next 2 days, and then we will have your stuff there. We are just preparing. You have 2 days. Then you must give me some more information about what's going on. If you do not invade in 2 days, and you do not have your item, or any proof that you have what I need, you will not want to see the light of... You will not see the light of day after that. Sir, listen. It is dangerous in these times. I know it is dangerous, but this is very important. All right, fine. And you see the fancy-looking individual stand up and walk out as the other guy, who you know is Jim, because his name was mentioned, Jim, he goes, fuck. All right. And he seems to stand up and walk away as well.
Okay, so... I've heard mentioned, so I'm definitely, Burbit's definitely somewhat concerned about that. Mm-hmm. Thinking, now he's thinking, Alright, so how far away were they from Burbit?
They're about 30 feet-ish from you, but they have already,
yeah, so they...
the fancy-looking individuals walked out of the bar, the other ones walked up to the bar, so he's like within 5 feet of you, sitting down, and ordering a drink.
Alright, so I guess while... So I guess seeing this, Burbit's going to, you know, pretend... He's going to act like he didn't really hear anything at the moment. So, yeah, he's just going to continue drinking. I guess that... I guess while the guy orders a drink, he's going to... He'll ask something. So what brings you into town?
Oh, just some work with my mercenary guild currently. What about you, stranger? You don't look like you're from these parts.
I guess something similar.
Ah. Well, birds of a feather, as they say. Anyways, you have a wonderful night, good sir. And he, this human man in this town, steps up and walks away.
Alright. So, I'm just thinking... So, actually, I'm definitely... Well, okay, so I'm not going to tail Jim or do anything like that, but right now I'm just thinking, and it's late at night, so we're going to be going to sleep. Alright. It would be a good idea to go to sleep at this point in time.
Alright, so you head up to your room and go to sleep. As you sleep, I'd like you to make me a will saving throw, please.
Will save?
Yes.
Alright, yeah, it's about... Yep, that would be that. That's a 17.
You dream, and a fog rolls over your mind. You see... a city of stone. Upon a large bluff. Overlooking a forest. A strange forest. You see a tribe of barbarians. And you see what seems to be a cave. A female orc entering into the cave. A human man waiting outside of it. A worried look on his face. A roar erupts from the cave, and the sound of a breaking of a chain. And you awaken the next day.
Oh, that was a strange dream. Should probably get to... probably should get to that tailor's place. Need to be presentable for the job at... for Chopping Foe, I guess.
Okay. So, you begin to walk around through the city. Roll me a diplomacy check to see if you can find Taylor's accessories.
Alright. That's a 16.
Asking around, you eventually do find Taylor's accessories. It takes you about half the day, though, because it's completely... Actually, no, it wouldn't take you. It's on the opposite side of the city, but it takes you a few hours to get there and ask around and everything. You eventually find it. And as you're walking there, you definitely enter the flower district during the daytime. And a lot of the buildings here are closed down. You could see... drunk individuals passed out in alleyways, or people stammering around holding their head, stopping the light from getting into their eyes. And you see normal people walking around looking at them like they're disgusting people. And eventually you make it to a small stone building, which is pretty rare for, like, the normal buildings around here, because most of them are made of wood, due to, you know, the fucking elves here. But there are, like, stone towers and stuff, so there are still stone buildings, but it's pretty rare in this district. Most of them in this district are wood. So as you approach it, you can see, its roof comes up to a curved point of brass, and you can see a sign hanging on that curved, crescent moon like wave shape of brass, and it says Taylor's Accessories, and you can see there is a flower mark behind the wording, as well as a sewing needle and string passing for the top of the T. You see glass windows at the front that seem to be currently darkened, and there is a little bit of light coming from inside, and you see these stands, mannequins almost. These just, only the chest area of mannequins, like the entire torso. And you see, you see full mannequins, sorry, made of wood, and you see these dresses, these beautiful necklaces and rings, these hats and whatnot. You see a sundress, you see a beautiful suit that's been tailored, you see these wonderful shoes. Actually, no, you wouldn't see shoes because I don't make shoes here, sorry. You see rings, necklaces, hats, you see clothing. Do you enter?
Sure.
Alright, you enter through the glass-like door that seems to be darker than the rest of it, and as you enter, you hear ding-ding-ding-ding-ding, and you look up, you see a bell attached to the top of the door. You enter into a small little hallway that's maybe 5 feet forward, at the edge of the door where the glass display cases go. And you walk forward. As you get to the edge of this hallway, it expands outwards into an actual open shop concept type thing with these tables that seem to have glass covering some of them in the further back. The ones in front of you, however, seem to be open, and there's mannequins standing on them with clothing and different hats and... you see further back, there seems to be, in the glass display case, it's just from where you're looking, jewelry. You see, upon the walls, there are these little cubby elements where you can see shirts and other things have been folded and placed inside to the left and right of you. And then you can see paintings on the walls of very regal-looking individuals. Two of them, one to the left and one to the right wall. A female to the left and a male to the right. The right one looks like a count. The left one looks like a countess. The left one you actually see is an elf woman, and underneath it is it mentions a name, which you can see here, which would be... Where's my NPC's list? There it is. Liette Leodel, First Princess of Tirok. And you can see this green, almost captain's attire. It has a small buckled shirt that has three, it looks like a count attire. I don't know how to explain it. I'm fucking stupid right now. Anyways, if you look in NPCs, basically, and you go up to Captain Walcott, which you could find eventually, you'll see what I mean. It's similar to that, but it's not blue, it's green for the jacket. I can at you actually for it really quick. There it is. Reply at the shadowy. There we go. Shadowy. There you go. It's basically this, but it's green for the color. And it's made for a female.
Alright.
So that's and it's not as loosely undone, it is tightly fitted. So it's like actually placed together properly. Anyways, and buttoned is what I meant to say. Anyways, so, and on the right you see a human count, and it says, well, not a count, but a nobleman, and it says, Sir Marquez Phoenix. I think that's his name? Fuck, I forget. I'm gonna look up the NPCs and see if that's his name or not. Because I might have given you the wrong name here. Sir... Ember Phoenix, there it is. Marquez Phoenix is a different person. Yeah, Sir Ember Phoenix, member of the Royal Court of Durath. And you see this this man in this beautiful clothing that seems to be filled with a fur-lined a coat. Anyways, you see all this stuff. You see mannequins. You see shrubbery in here. You see a glass, a wooden table at the back with a glass top to it. That seems to create a counter almost that blocks off the entire 10 feet of the back of the store. And you can see just displays of jewelry as you walk in. You see golden rings, silver rings, you see earrings, you see necklaces, you see toe rings, you see pendants, other things like that as you look at it. As you're looking, there's this thumping sound in the back from a door behind the counter. And you see, opening the door, there's this frantic individual, this elven woman that seems to be in her, if she was a human, late 30s, so she's middle-aged, basically. You can see her eyes are sagged and have bags under them right now. Her hair is knotted up in a bun, but it's not like a very fancy bun. It seems like she just threw her hair up and tied it in. You can see that she's currently wearing she's wearing a tank top. A wife beater like shirt. It'll be more of a tank top, I'd say. A tank top that is just covered in like food and sweat. Well, not food, it'll be just sweat. You can see sweat around her cleavage area and under her armpits very badly. As she starts to walk out, you can see that her jacket is tied around her waist and she has some comfy looking pajama pants on. As she comes walking out, you see she has these glasses that she's putting on, and she goes, hello, how are you?
Alright, I just heard that this place was a good tailor spot.
Oh, yes. Who were you recommended by chance? Because depending on who, you may get a discount.
Alright. Yeah, it was, I'm trying to remember the name, it was...
Lieta.
Yeah, Lieta. Lieta,
I do remember making those golden caps for her. I don't really know her too well, so I'm sorry, but I won't be able to give you a discount, for just knowing her. Why are we talking price right now? What can I get you?
Well, I mainly just need to get my clothes repaired. I kind of just lift up my, or push my breastplate to the side to show off my rather simple traveler's clothes.
Oh my gosh, you've been traveling in this?
Yeah, I mean, it keeps me warm in the when it rains.
I see, well, and she seems to put her hand up to her mouth and her upper chin. I could repair it or I could give you some new clothing if you wanted to. Repairing it would be... Eh. But anyways, if you do want me to repair your clothing, I could do so for 5 copper pieces.
Well, that sounds like a pretty good deal.
If you wanted to buy some more explorer's clothing to have you protected from the elements, you could just give me a single silver piece instead, however.
A new set, eh?
Yes. Mm.
Okay, I see it then?
What?
Oh, okay, so I guess, alright, so basically she's offering me a similar piece of this kind of clothing.
Yes, it has some difference to it. It has more green and white to it rather than, like, the, color of, like, sand kind of beige that you're used to. And she goes, if you would like, you could have this. It would cost double the price just because I'm not fixing a piece of clothing for you. Or I can make you some personal clothing if you would wish me to.
I'm guessing the personal one's price is quite dependent on what I want.
Oh, yes, yes. If you're looking for a tuxedo, for example, that would cost you somewhere around 55 gold. That would be 2 gold, because technically that is fine clothing, not high fashion. Meanwhile, if you're looking for something like a nobleman would wear, that would be 55-ish gold. Well, that's the price, of course.
I'll go with the explorer's clothes that are a better color for this area. I have a feeling it might be useful.
Of course. Well, then, that would be one silver piece, please.
Alright. I'll give her the silver piece.
Alright, she hands you your clothing and goes, is there anything else I can get for you? Maybe a piece of jewelry? And she points at the display case.
Yeah, I'm a bit low on funds. I have a job, so I might be able to come back here soon.
Well, maybe you're looking for... I guess you... After you say that, she goes, well, if you do come back, maybe you could find some, maybe you could hire me to make some, fashion for one of your lady friends. And she nudges you and, like, opens up a small curtain behind her where you can see a cubby that's hidden, and you can see, some very finely made, raunchy kind of designs, some lingerie. And she goes, I do some work for the local brothels and whatnot around here, so if you're looking for some high-quality items similar to for the bedroom, I have quite a selection as well.
Alright.
I would just ask that you don't have me make personal clothing unless you're going to pay me a lot, because I have a large pack order right now. Anyways, if you're looking for that stuff later, please come back. Anyways, I need to get back to working, and she runs back to the back, back up her staircase behind, and you hear her fall on the stairs, go ah, and get back up and walk up again.
I realize I never asked her name, but she kind of went off, so it's like, I guess I'll ask you when I come back here.
All right, so you leave the store.
Kermit's also gonna go make sure he's cleaned up, and then. Because he plans on going to find... Oh, yes, Zer.
Oh, yes, Zer? Zer?
Oh, yes. Zer.
Anyway, so, as you clean up and get ready, it's about night at this point by the time you walk back, forward, basically. So, as you're getting back, and it's about 4 o'clock in the afternoon, basically, getting towards nighttime, you decide to head towards the palace to try and talk to Oyez?
I'd say I'd at least try to see where she is. If I know that it's at the palace, it's 4. There's still a couple hours left of the day.
It's 2 hours before it starts to get to sunset.
Yeah.
Anyway, so you can make a diplomacy check to see if you know where Oyez is.
Alright, I guess I'm gonna at least try to figure out where she's staying. In that case. Alright, let's see here. Alright, yeah, I don't really find anything.
What'd you roll?
5.
5. You have no idea. And by the time it's about getting ready to be, like, starting sunset, someone says, isn't she like the new court mage for the palace?
Alright, now, well, at least I've found out where she is. I used to think, I guess I'll try to get that in the morning.
Alright. So,
thanks for the help.
As you begin to head back, you see the district and the flower district becomes lit up again in the distance. And you begin to head back to the western gate, and at this point, you hear somebody declare themselves as, "Well, if you need any help in the future, ma'am, my name is Morgan. You can find me, ask around for me, or I will find you." And then you see this cloaked woman, this green cloaked woman, who seems unimportant to you at the moment. Nod, say okay, and then walk towards the mage's respite.
As, just some lady in a green cloak.
Yeah, as you see Morgan, this elven-looking individual with a wider grayish kind of skin, and this bluish, dark blue kind of hair, start to walk away. But this is Morgan, if you wanted to talk to him.
Yeah, so considering what Herbert heard from Bill, he's thinking, I should probably at the very least try. So, Herbert's gonna go try catching up with Morgan. Oh, hey, hey!
Hello, do I know you?
Probably not.
Oh, well, it's always great to make friends and acquaintances. Hello, my name's Morgan. How can I help you?
Burbet.
I was
staying at, your... Well, looking at him, I'm assuming adopted father's in the Mage's Respite.
Oh, Bill's, yes.
Yeah. He said he had a... You guys had a falling out.
Oh, yes. He did not like what I've been doing recently and told me I'm going to get myself killed soon. Oh, what a funny man. He's just been on my ass all the time. I really don't like that. So we kind of went our separate ways about a month ago. So, what about it? Are you always into people's personal family affairs, or...?
Well, it was kind of a favor. And I guess I understand. We kind of just met, so I wouldn't blame you if you weren't gonna listen to me on this. But he kind of asked me to tell you that he wants to talk, try to smooth things over.
He always wants to talk. Go ahead and roll me a diplomacy check.
All right. All right. That's a 21.
21. He looks at you, and he just stares at you intently. Oh, he really wants to smooth things over. Really, that's what he said. Well, I've got some business tonight, and I got some business in his establishment tomorrow with one of his tenants. After that, I'll go meet with him and Lieta and see what he wants. You can tell him I'll be there tomorrow.
Oh, that's great.
Anyways, thank you, Burbit, for getting involved in my personal family affairs. It makes for a great introduction.
Well, I'm sorry about that.
He walks off. Man, really fleshing out this dead character, huh?
Oh, no. Well, Burbit, happy that he's... Well, I kind of feel a little bad about being like that, but happy that he's at least helping smooth a family trouble over. Anyway, he's going to go back to the inn.
I will say you did see him wearing a golden pendant around his neck. So really quickly, just so you guys are aware, this would be the day you came in, Ruby, which would be the day, no, they did come in later after you, Ruby, technically, funny enough, their two characters came in the same night, but after you.
Oh no, I think I know what's happening.
You would see them walk away, he goes back out, comes back in with two other individuals, and then he says, alright, you owe me a favor, and then he does a conversation with you. But, he then, out of character, this guy dies tomorrow in-game.
I'm assuming it's because he gets his dick sucked so hard he loses his soul.
Yeah, that's who it is. And out of character, Zeus and Big Shot never asked this guy his name.
Oh, dear.
Anyways.
R.I.P. Morgan.
Yep. This was supposed to be an NPC that was supposed to give you missions and jobs and be like that cool uncle guy who's like all cool with you, like a good friend, and then there's a twist in the future. But no, they just killed him in their first solo sessions. So that was fun to deal with. Anyways, so as you walk back to the mage's respite and you walk in, you see Lieta at the counter, who seems to be serving some alcohol and whatnot to other people. And you see Jim once again at the counter. He seems to be tapping nervously.
All right. So I guess I'm gonna head up to the. I guess I'll head up to the bar.
Okay.
I think I'll just have some water.
All right. So you order some water, and as you're drinking, you see the regal-looking figure enter once again, and you see Jim stand up and walk towards him. Roll me another perception check, please.
It's an 18.
18?
Yep.
Alright. Yeah. You hear. Jim, I'm hoping for some information today rather than for having called me out here. It seems, they're planning to attack. They were planning to attack, a few days ago, and my information was late. It seems they've already, attacked the town. I'm still waiting for information on what happened after that, but it seems we are on schedule once again. That is good to hear. Do you have any of that payment you promised us? Remember what we said. Delivered payment upon your delivery. Yeah, but you gotta realize, we've just lost quite a few resources that we needed to use, and I'm gonna roll a diplomacy check for both of them. Okay. And he goes, Jim, if your people have truly attacked, I will give you 10% of your profit now, but if I find unacceptable results, there will be consequences.
Okay, sure.
And you hear a visible kshing as he puts down this coin purse, and you look over for a second. The coin purse is bigger than his palm. If you'd like to, you can roll me a... What fucking checks are there here? Let me go to, society. What skills are there? I need to see what this would be. I don't think it's lore. I don't think it's...
Guessing, lore is like, has 10 trillion different things for basically everything.
History, important personalities, legal institutions, social structure, and human cultures. Okay, so you can use society, further, you can use that knowledge to navigate the complex physical, societal, and economic workings of settlements, even if you're untrained in it. You can understand the people and systems that make a civilization run, and you can know the historical events that make... So yeah, go ahead and make me a society check, or a perception check, it's your choice.
I'll go with perception.
Okay.
Because my barbarian senses are too good.
Yeah.
That's a 15?
15. Just from the sound of the coins hitting each other, there's probably a good... like over 100 coins in there, whatever they may be, and you rolled a 15. It's either silver or gold, because copper makes a more makes a less king noise in this world. It makes a more king, like a duller noise. So your ears pick this up and you look and you're like, oh shit, that's 10%. What are they having Jim do?
Oh,
and Jim goes, thank you. I'll make sure this gets to them. You have a good day, sir. And he goes, Jim, do not disappoint me. And he gets up and starts to walk out. And Jim sits there for a second. It's at this point, the guy wouldn't stand up and then walk out, because there was another conversation that happened with him and Jim at this point. Sorry. So he continues to talk to Jim, and there's a conversation that you can't quite hear because it gets a little bit ruckusy and loud, due to the fucking strange dwarf man and human trying to riz up Lieta. Actually, no. Technically, right now, I'm trying to think what's happening at the moment. So, in time,
they didn't do the timeline together.
I don't think they did it the first day. No. Actually, no, they did do it the first day. So, those... I had to retcon a little bit of what happened here. So, I'll say Jim talked to him, and they started talking a little bit longer. But nothing seems to be strange about their talk. Eventually, the human man asks for a room from Lieta. Lieta says, sure, and says, if you want me to carry you up to your room, you gotta give me a kiss on the cheek. The human man jumps up and kisses her on the cheek. Lieta, standing at her full height and not crouching down a little bit, is 6'10", by the way. And they go upstairs. She comes back down. After you drink and you're about to start walking upstairs, this strange dwarven man walks downstairs and tries to riz up Lieta. As you eventually find your way up to your room for the night. I'm just trying to get the order of events really quickly. Yeah, that's what happened, okay. So, at this point, you sleep for the night. You wake up the next morning feeling well and rested. What do you do?
Okay, now considering the fact that I was just about to go find my employer, I am going to do that immediately. Since I am aware that she is the court mage, I'm going to make an attempt to find her.
Okay, make me... So you manage to get to the castle, and there seems to be guards. So the castle itself is built into and then around wrapping up the tree a little bit. You see balconies popping out and a few rooms that pop off of the tree. And it seems the branches have a few rooms in or on them as well. And there's this marble staircase leading up to the main entrance with large statues, these bushes and shrubs that go upwards as well. And then there's these waterfalls on the sides that fall down to many different platforms going down and falling into reflecting pools on the sides of it. This is coming out of the palace garden, by the way. And as you look up to the staircase, as you start to approach... you see a guard, a man in full plate with a halberd, stops you before you get to the stairs and goes, "Sorry, official business only for the palace. Do you have a note of a notoriety of coming in? Do you have a meeting with anybody? Why are you coming here?"
All right. Do I have any paperwork that would say I was with, that I plan on meeting with?
You were never specifically hired. You were just told of the job and given the thing. So you do have the paper that mentions it. But...
So I guess I do pull that out and say, I don't think it's exactly that official, but I am coming here to speak with, Zier.
Roll me a diplomacy check and add a plus one extra because you're using the pamphlet that she put out.
All right. Bruh.
By the way, this is like early morning you're doing this, just so you're aware.
Like, alright, yeah, okay.
As you pull out the pamphlet, it's just completely soaked. And you remember that time you fell in the river?
Oh, shit.
He goes, "We don't like your kind around here. Now scram."
Alright,
so... Yez would never hire an orc like you. Fucking green skins. And he starts to go back to his post.
Alright, so, Burba's thinking, alright.
Time to kill some palace guards.
Burba's gonna go away a little. He's just thinking, alright, how am I going to get to the, how am I gonna get to, oh yes. Now, he's going for a couple things in his head. He could try to sneak in, but that's just a bad idea because, okay, if he gets caught, that's gonna make him look even worse. Right now, he's just some random orc guy who's bought a soaked piece of paper trying to talk with the court mage. So.
As you're thinking about this in the garden, I want you to roll me a perception check, please.
Alright. That's a 23?
23. Alright. You see, rushing out of the palace, really quickly, down the stairs, holding on to a few papers, going through them through a few books, this tall elven woman who seems to have these long ears and platinum rings floating around them with this white hair and snow white skin. As she's rushing through, she seems to be holding the papers to her chest and the book to her chest as well. She looks around really quickly and says something to the guard and rushes off through the garden past you. She goes, "Oh, come on, oh yes." And she continues to walk out of the garden.
All right. So, yeah, I am going to... Okay, so, yeah, she just walks by me.
Yeah, she runs by, like, fast-paced walks. And she is much taller than you. I think I said she was, like, 7 foot tall, right?
Yeah, 7 feet tall.
Yeah,
7 feet.
She's an elf, so she has a 30-foot move speed.
However, it seems like as she's moving, you could see her jittering and, like, she's there 1 second, but then, like, time... It seems like she's moving faster than she should be. It's almost like space is weird around her. She's moving faster. Actually, hold up. Would she be here right now? Because technically, she was not working in her lab the night before. She technically would be. Yes, she would be. Yeah. Okay, so yeah, no, this event does happen.
Alright. So, considering that my employer has just ran past me, Burbit's thinking, alright, I gotta go get her. Burbit's going to try to pursue... Oh, yes. He's going to also try to call out to her when he's away from the palace, not to not rouse the guard's suspicion.
Okay. As you call out to her and you're going down the main center area, she seems to be heading towards the eastern edge of the city, and she's like, fuck, fuck, fuck. And you yell, oh, yes! Oh, yes! And she goes, not now, whoever you are, I don't give a fuck, I need to do something, gosh, where? And she keeps dropping papers, and she's like, I don't need it, and she continues to walk. She eventually is going, and you see her walking down the flower district early in the morning as the lights are starting to fade out, and roll me a perception check, please, roll me a survival check to keep following her, as at the moment there's still a crowd of people here.
Uh-oh. Okay, let's see there.
She's moving quickly.
Yeah, let's look at my skills.
Okay,
I got that. All
right,
so let's
pull up the character sheet just to get her actual stats up. Because you might get into combat with her.
Alright, that's a 14.
14?
Yeah.
Okay, give me 1 second here to pull up her stats. Load character. Oh, yeah, Zir. 1907, yeah. Open. Seer Elf Heritage, so she has skills. Because technically she's using a passive, well, a stealth check, but she has disadvantage technically. But yeah, you manage to continue to see her just through the crowd, but like as you're trying to push past people, they seem to be like this large crowd, and she seems to just be like stepping through them. And you see her about to run into somebody, and then she flashes and then appears somewhere else like 5 feet away and continues to walk. I'm gonna make a perception check here, because this technically does happen. Okay, so, as she's starting to get towards, the end, and you can see a wizard tower in the distance, and you figure maybe she's headed there, and you're like, okay, that's probably where she's headed. You eventually start to lose sight of her, and then you see her maybe 20 feet ahead of her, ahead of you, and then you see a few individuals just knock her into an alleyway and run in after her.
Like, knock her into an alleyway.
Like,
and run
they
after
sidewind,
her.
Push her in, and then run in after her.
Okay.
In this crowded place, it's not really noticed besides by you.
Alright, so. Verb's thinking, oh shit. Alright, gotta help out. Yeah, so Verb's gonna go and try to help out his employer.
Alright, so you start to get over there. As you start to run over, you see flashes coming from the alleyway. And you see an individual start to walk out, and you see him grasping at his face, this older elf-looking gentleman. He's like, and he's just grasping at his face, and you can visibly see him aging and aging even more as he just steps out of the alleyway, turns to dust as his body hits the floor. you continue to walk into the alleyway?
Alright, so seeing that, I assume... So he was probably one of the guys that went... That was trying to get... Oh, yes?
You don't know.
Oh, yes?
You just saw an old man walking down an alleyway and turned to dust hitting the floor.
Okay. So, considering that... I'm thinking... Alright. But considering what I saw, I'm assuming it's some kind of fight.
You don't know. You haven't seen anything besides the flashes of light from the alleyway and a man walk out and turn to dust.
Yeah, I know.
Okay, I'm gonna roll again for the next initiative order.
Yeah, I'm proceeding with caution.
Okay, so as you start to slowly sneak up towards the alleyway, you don't hear anything and you don't see anything from the alleyway.
So he can't see anything inside of it?
You haven't gotten to the alleyway yet. You're still sneaking up to it. Because you're cautiously approaching. Right. And I'd like you to make me a stealth check, please. Or a performance check to blend in.
Alright, so stealth check. That would be that. Okay. Oh, there we go. Okay. Alright, that's a 12.
Alright. As you sneak up, I'm gonna roll a perception check, and they have a bonus because they're fucking elves. So as you start to sneak up, you turn and look into the alleyway, and you see Oyez on the ground, unconscious. Her thing sprawled around her as these two other individuals, heavy marks of arcane like magic have hit them recently, and they are bleeding. And you can see one of them is looking at his arm literally mummify for a second as it's starting to creep up his arm. He takes his sword and just cuts it off. As the arm hits the ground, he just burns and cauterizes it. And they seem to be talking, but as they're talking, you can't hear anything from the alleyway. What are you doing? As you see the one that cut off his arm starts to grab a bunch of the research notes and stuff into a
yeah,
satchel as the other one
it's
starts to take
what's going
up,
on here.
The other one takes Oyez and starts to drag her deeper into the alleyway.
Alright.
What are you planning on doing?
Okay, Burbus the Barbarian, he's gonna start a murdering.
Alright, so as you start to step towards the alleyway, getting ready to do whatever you need to do, you feel this strange molasses-like barrier pass over you as soon as you take a single step into the alleyway. And the sounds outside from the actual streets just vanish. And you could hear, "Fuck, grab her already, let's go!" Wait, someone just passed the barrier. And they both look towards you, because they got a natural 20 on their perception check. So that was like 25. And they both look over to you, "Fuck, kill him!" And you see the one who cut off his arm, "Fine!" And he pulls out a magic wand and points it at you. I need you to make me a dexterity saving throw, please.
So reflex save.
Roll me a reflex save really quick versus their reflex save to see who goes first.
Who goes? So we're doing initiative that way.
It's just gonna, you know, we'll just have it be, just roll a dexterity check for me, and we'll just use that for
initiative. Dexterity.
Yeah, because they know you're there and they're about to shoot something at you, but we're seeing if you go before that.
Initiative is the same as in D&D.
No, there's different ways to initiate initiative, actually.
Yeah.
Pathfinder 2E.
Yeah, Pathfinder,
you
you
could roll,
skills.
Like, if, for example, if you're trying to be a societal, like, based thing, you're trying to deceive someone into not attacking your party, you could have it be, like, a deception versus their will save for initiative start, because, like, if they figure out, like, your shit or something, you could see who goes first. Like, if he figures out you're deceiving him to get an attack of opportunity on him first, then he wouldn't be able to go first. But if he realizes your deception, he can go first. Something like that. Or if you're stealthing, stuff like that. It's weird. I just like to do dexterity, though. Yeah, anyway.
But
so
it is worth noting that attack of opportunity is a feature in
yes,
Pathfinder.
Yes, I know. I'm just saying an opportune attack. Anyway, right. So what'd you roll?
12.
So, the one dragging the body, starts to look around. He tries to drag the body, but you stepped into the alley, and he's shouting to the guy to move, and the other guy pulls out his wand and shoots a lightning bolt at you. I need you to make a reflex save, please.
Alright. Alright. It's a 15.
Okay, let me just pull up the spell here. Alright, so as he sends it forward 15, reflex save. Yeah, that fails. His DC is 16 here. So, he sends it forward as he goes, ah, in Elven, he says, do you speak Elven, actually?
No.
He says, Igir! And as he does, points the blackened wand at you as this bolt of lightning strikes towards you, and it strikes you straight in the chest cavity for... Oh god, how much health do you have?
I got... Oh, see here, yeah, it's like 23?
Okay, so you did manage to evade it to an extent, but because you are aware of it, I will give you... I will give you half damage because you see him about to cast a spell at you. I'm just gonna give it to you because otherwise you would die. So, and it messes with my lore narrative here. He points at you and shoots, and as he does, the wand shoots. It hits you in the stomach, but you manage to pull your body a little bit away, so it kind of like hooks your body instead of like hitting you directly. So you step out of the way a little bit, and you take 14 points of lightning damage. That's already halved. As 14. The wand suddenly whoosh, turns to ash in his hand, and you see, as you look to your right, the lightning bolt hits the barrier you just stepped through and dissipates at that point. The barrier's still up.
Alright.
And the elf who's 30 feet away from you go... Well, actually, this elf would be about 50 feet away from you. The other one who is pulling Oyez is about 70 feet. He goes, fuck, fuck, fuck. It's your turn.
Okay, so that gives me about 3 actions. Now, I guess okay. I was looking at my resources. All right, I'm going to use my first action to rage.
Okay.
And then...
I'll say you could have already raged as you stepped into the barrier, because that was like, I would have given you one action at that point to do, because I said, what are you readying up to do?
Okay, in that case, if I was raging, I'll subtract, I get temp HP for raging.
You don't get temp HP, you just get damage negation, I believe.
No, you get temp HP in this.
Let me check. I'm thinking of Pathfinder 1E, aren't I? Okay. Let's see. You take a -1 penalty to AC. Can't concentrate. Can't seek.
But you can seek.
You gain a temporary HP equal to your con mod, plus your level.
Plus your level.
Yeah. Frenzy lasts for 1 minute until there are no enemies you can perceive or until you fall unconscious.
Right.
Okay. Just making sure.
Okay. Alright. Okay.
And because they're not
that means I have 13
armor.
HP left. Okay, and now, since I have 3 actions, I'm going to use my first action to use Sudden Charge. Charge lets me stride twice, which lets me move 50 feet, and then if I get right next to a creature, I can make an attack.
Okay, yeah, you get right up to the first one. If you want to go past him, you can get about, I think I said 70 feet from the other one, right?
Yeah, except the other one's 70 feet away.
Yeah, so you could push the guy to the other side of you and get between the two so that you don't have to run past this guy if you don't kill him.
Alright. So I get right to the other side of this guy, and now since Sudden Charge lets me make an attack, I'm going to make an attack against the guy that tried casting at me.
Okay. So as you get right behind him, you just swing your axe in this... Almost like time has, like, you're basically Quicksilver at this point. You rush up right behind him and jump off of your feet for a second to turn your whole body to get a swing at him. Go ahead and roll to hit.
Alright. Yeah, so also I am using a bastard sword.
Okay.
Alright. Oh, there we go. I just need to correct that. Okay, there we go.
What'd you roll to hit?
I was just correcting something.
Okay.
Okay, that's a 17 to hit.
That hits their AC. As you see these guys aren't wearing anything besides clothing, you hit and you're expecting to cut very easily, but you feel resistance underneath their clothing and you realize they're wearing armor underneath their clothing.
Alright.
As you go ahead and roll damage.
Okay. That's going to be 1d12 as I'm wielding it with two hands, plus four cold damage from my Draconic Rage.
Okay. I think you can get a minimum amount of damage and just kill him anyways. But go ahead and roll. Right. We'll see.
Yeah, all right, let's see. That's 15 damage.
Yeah, he's at 5 health after having his arm mummified. So, yeah, you slash him, and though there's a little bit of resistance, once you pass that, you literally chop him in half. The top of his body goes flying up with a blood streak arc into the air. And lands directly behind the other guy 20 feet behind you, and he just looks at it and goes,
Alright, so I have one more action left. And with that action, I think I'm going to move right next to this guy.
Alright. You move right up to him, and he just looks at you in the face. So, does that end your turn?
That would be the end of my turn.
He's gonna drop her as a free action, use his first action to scream. Use his second action to strike at you with his hatchet. Does an 11 hit you?
No, it does not.
And use his third action to fucking run away 30 feet.
Alright.
Well, hold up. 25 feet, sorry. So, like, he runs away, nearly trips, and continues to run 25 feet away.
Alright.
Still carrying in his satchel the extra shit. Actually, no, he wasn't the one carrying it. It was the other one.
Alright.
Anyways. Dying guy's turn. The last thoughts going through his mind are... Ugh. That ends his turn. And that was a roll of a natural 20 on my end, so, like, it's waste. But anyways.
He's just barely alive.
Like, you could hear him... Anyways, your turn.
Alright. So, I'm gonna use... Alright, since I'm raging and I'm pretty sure, yeah, it's basically I'm in a frenzy, so I have to kill everyone. Or all the enemies.
You don't have to.
If
there's no enemies around you, your frenzy ends.
Okay. But right now, since this guy's trying to run away, and unfortunately for him, he's not quick enough. It's unfortunate for him that he's not quick enough to escape.
Like, he's running into, like, garbage cans as you're chasing him, like, trying to push them behind him, and you just step over them.
Yeah, so I just use sudden charge. So, how tall is this guy?
You're basically doing the fucking Horaloo fight against this man. From Elden Ring.
Yeah, that's like, except if Horaloo was literally the size of a dwarf. Yeah, so just this, it's just this, like, teenage boy who's, like, literally the size of a dwarf.
You know, like, when Horaloo, like, suddenly charges, but it's not, like, really fast, but he does a, like, large span of a charge?
It's just like,
yeah.
Great, you have bastard sword raise, and I'm gonna try attacking him.
Alright, what was your question about this guy?
Oh, I was just wondering how tall he was.
He's about 6 foot, because he's an elf.
So this 6 foot guy is getting chased by some 4'10" dude. And the screaming in fear. Okay, so I'm using sudden charge. So I move stride twice, and since I'm right up next to him, I'm gonna attack.
Okay, go ahead.
Okay. All right, that's up. That's a 26.
It's not 10
AC
higher. It's not 10 higher.
Okay.
You missed it by one.
I was just thinking, oh no, I'm gonna crit him. I'm just critting this man. Alright. Okay. Oh, with that, sign the roll damage. For my first strike, That's 15 damage.
Okay, so as you bring your first strike down, you just slice him in half from your charge and just go, like, in the middle of your charge, you bring it down and you manage to go straight through him after your slice. Covered in blood now.
Alright, so with that, I just use my final action to toss my bastard sword to the ground and beat my chest, roaring like, yeah, just roaring to the sky.
So, as you do so, and the barrier drops, people hear from an alleyway that was previously quiet. I'm gonna make a perception check for the crowd. Okay, so you see a few people look in, see the blood-covered alley. Guards! You, a half-orcish man who's already been shown racism from the guards at the palace, are next to the unconscious court mage, next to two dead, slain individuals in the middle of this alleyway, roaring like a dragon. Covered in blood.
So I'm assuming at this point my rage ends, and I'm thinking, oh, crap.
Yeah, you're like, oh.
Alright, that was a...
So.
Okay, so the guards are coming at this point.
Most likely.
Now, I'm just thinking of a few things. Alright, so actually, I'm in an alleyway, so I'm assuming I could try going in that direction.
Could.
Actually, in that case, I'm thinking, okay. I realize, this looks bad, so I'm gonna do this. So I just put my bastard sword in its sheath, and I sort of raise my hands, like.
Okay, make me a diplomacy check.
That's like, all right, guys, I know
as you wait
bad,
a bit,
but...
death save. Fail. That's death 2.
Alright. Okay. That's a 13?
13? Alright. So, the guards eventually come about a minute later. Are you trying to stop the fucking court maids from dying?
Before the guards
actually,
get here,
no,
I'm gonna go.
They would have done non-lethal damage to her, technically. So yeah, no, she's not dying, but...
It's just unconscious.
I will remind you, the court mage is unconscious in front of you. Do you want to do anything with that?
I guess I'll just make sure she's okay. I'm gonna have my arms raised. When I get down to her, I'm just gonna check her.
Okay.
Basically see if she hasn't hit her head, stuff like that.
She is unconscious and drooling on the ground, and you could hear under her breath, she's going, diagrams, workshop, inverted, celestial stars, the moon, find, oakage, find somebody, send there. That's all you could hear from her. She's just rambling nonsense to you.
Alright. So yeah, she's okay. In that case, I'm gonna try to appear as non-threatening as possible. You know, just so... Because I don't want... Because if I try running, that's gonna make me look suspicious. And if they catch me, I'm not gonna have as good of a story. At least if I just stay here and try to surrender, I have that.
Okay, so... As you are dragged into the palace dungeon by the guards... because you failed the check. Eventually, later in the day, you are brought out and questioned, and the court mage, with an ice pack on her head, comes in and says, "This isn't the man that attacked me. Those ruffians in the alley did. What are you doing with this man? Let him go already. Jeesh." And the guards look at you, spit on you, and let you go. They push you out of the palace stairway, granting your items back, and the guard out front goes, "You are really stupid, aren't you?"
In what way?
Societal ways.
I mean, I guess to be fair, there's probably better ways I could have handled that situation.
Yes, but... there is. I'll talk to... You said you wanted to see Oyez, correct, earlier?
Yeah.
And you saved her life. I'll see if I can get you in a meeting with her, but we'll have to send a few guards into the room because you were there when she was attacked.
Alright, thanks, man.
Whatever, Greenskin. Just give me a few minutes. And he walks away as the other guard just stares at you.
I say, Burbis walks away happily. Good, glad that things turned out well.
So you just, he said, I'm going to get you a meeting in a few minutes, and you walk away.
Actually, oh wait, I'm staying there then.
I guess it was
a couple minutes.
This man.
I thought he was meeting a couple hours. All right, no, yeah, I missed the couple minutes part.
So as the half point of the day, it's around noon at this point. You're allowed in with a few guards, pushed through the forest. You see, as you enter, the main foyer of the palace is larger than the tree's trunk. And you're like, how is that possible? Something must be going on here. I don't know what the fuck this means. You're unsure of what's happening here. You led through the palace, up a few stairs, through a few hallways, flanked by 5 guards, mind you. Eventually, you get to a point where there's just this branch that leads off of the tree, to your knowledge from the outside of the tree, look as you head up a staircase, and you see a doorway that leads into the branch, and the guards just look at you, ready for you to open it.
Alright, so I guess I open it, because
they
seem
to be... Roll me a fortitude save.
Oh. Okay.
Oh, this.
Bro, I'm gonna use my hero point to reroll that.
Okay.
Cause I don't know what kind of BS this is gonna do if I get a crit fail. Alright, that's 27.
You feel your stomach churn as you feel yourself pulled through the doorway, and you see everything go from, like, its normal, like, horizontal view to vertical. And suddenly you fall on your back on the ground, and you get this heavy sense of vertigo as the entire area around you shifts. And you were wondering at first, isn't a wizard's tower supposed to be straight up, not sideways like this branch? And you realize bullshit magic probably makes it that way. It straight up. And as you're in, you're like, you almost puked your guts out, but you managed to hold strong. And you look down, like, to your left, and the doorway is literally flat on the ground. And it's open. You see the other guards come in, and you see a few... Actually, I'm gonna roll. You see the guards, as soon as they get in, just hunch over and... onto the ground. Seems the guards don't like it either.
Huh?
Why isn't the guards always fail this? Ruby, it happened with you too. Why do the guards always fail this save?
I don't know.
Burbis can actually get his water out. Hey, you guys. I don't think you guys want to drink from the same thing I do, but he tries to find a cloth. You guys need this. A handkerchief.
You find this dirty, oil-filled handkerchief in the room, and you're like, nah, they won't need it. Anyway, so the room you see pushes forward into these large 2 stairs that head up to a second-story balcony above you. You see in the middle of this room, there's this globe that's very large of Taram itself. And you see the globe itself has like 70% of it covered in fog. And you're like, that's strange. You still see the area that you that the world looks like on it. You see above this large globe is a telescope that seems to point down towards the globe, and you see bits of sunlight and moonlight. Sunlight have hit parts of the globe in certain areas. You see a few stone tables that are large around this area with pieces of metal, bits of bobs, crystals, rings of metal. You see books spread out and papers spread out across these tables, yet you do not see Oyazir.
Very strange.
I will mention to you, this entire place is lit by glowing small crystals that are in different mechanical machines that you can see around the area, or even just natural light. There is no, like, candlelight in here.
Alright. So it's a well-lit...
It's lit enough for humans to see, just on the edge there.
Alright, that's the reason I ask is because I do have dark vision.
Okay.
Alright, so, Burbit's, thinking this is a pretty... I think since Burbit, entering this place almost threw up, he's thinking this is quite a confusing thing. And since I was being brought into this area to speak with Oyez, and she doesn't seem to be here. I guess I'll actually ask, hello?
As you say that, you hear, hello. As it echoes throughout, and you hear, I'm up here. Please, just bother my mechanical time with your meetings. Please, come here. Let's get this over with quick.
Alright, so I look up and she's. Alright, so yeah,
you see her hanging. You see her hanging over. Well, not hanging over the balcony, but putting her body over the balcony to look down, and she's holding a wrench. She's covered in soot on her face, and her hair is covered in it too. And she's just looking down at you. She seems to have not her clothing that she was wearing earlier, but she's wearing this tank top white beater shirt, and she has this almost mechanics like car. A mechanic zip-up jumpsuit on that seems to be halfway pulled down to her waist, and you can see the rings on her floating around her ears are sending off small arcane sparks. As she does look down to you, you can see the inside of her hair. It seems like the area inside her hair that seems to be nearing her face, like the back of her hair, basically, is dark in color, and it almost reflects like a star-like night. And you see in her eyes these speckles of almost starlight in her lavender eyes as she looks down at you. Her chest is big enough. Anyways, and you can see her hands are covered in cuts and like burns from arcane energy. And she looks down. Come up the stairs. We'll talk. Hurry up, please. I have many things to do here. I'm gonna change the inversion of this. Come up.
Yeah, so Verbit is gonna scuttle up the steps.
You're too slow. She snaps her fingers, and you feel everything around you slows down. But you're moving faster. Like, the guards that are following you are moving at a very slow speed compared to you as you go up the stairs.
Whee!
From an outside view, you move up to the stairs in, like, 2 seconds.
I don't know if the guard's gonna be all that happy about that.
The guards look up to her, and she goes, "You can stay down there. If I need your help, I'll call you up here." Anyways, she looks to you, wipes her forehead. She has these steampunk goggles on her head at the moment. What can I do for you? I'm kind of in the middle of this mechanical shit.
I was here about the job. I unfortunately don't have the flyer. It kind of got messed up in a lake I fell in.
You mean the job? Yes, I remember posting about that lake. Sure, whatever. You're here about the job of Oakage. Okay, so, quick little recap for you. I've been noticing a strange constellation that appeared 7 years ago in the sky. It's been moving around strangely compared to other constellations which don't follow a planetary movement. This one does. I've been bringing it up to my colleagues. They've said I'm crazy. I know I'm crazy, but still. And recently, I've been noticing some flares in the Aurora Borealis that exists above us that correlates with certain nights that this constellation shines brighter. And after some calculations, I've determined that recently, until I believe last night actually, strangely enough, which is why you found me running out to one of my older workshops outside of the courts, because I've only been here for 9 months, so I don't have everything here. Sorry. But recently, last night, I saw that it moved away from Oakage. And funny enough, actually, hold up. Two nights ago, it moved away from Oakage, the town, which it had been following over to an extent, not directly over a certain point of Oakage, but over parts of Oakage. And as I tried to scry, using my chronomantic abilities, I had determined that there was a symbol instead of scrying on a thing, a person, whatnot, I got a strange form of symbolism due to my scry, as I was looking at the places that Oakage had, originally, had the points pointed at. So, my symbolism that I saw was something about a moon and stars. Now, the job I have for you. Find your way to Oakage within the next day or two. which I'll try to arrange transport for, of course. Find the moon or star, or ask about it, and find how it's moved westward. But I want you to figure out what it means. Because it's strange that it's moved westward from Oakage recently. Find out what the star and moon means. Bring me back whatever you find. And you will be rewarded.
Okay.
Anyways, is there any questions?
I think there's probably something I should mention to you as you're in the you have a position in government. While I was at the Mage's Respite Inn, there was a couple individuals who were discussing an attack on Oakage. A raid, as they call it.
That may be bad. That may be that may actually be the reason it's moved westwards. That's some good information. Well, use that information to your advantage. Figure out if that raid has anything to do once you get to Oakage with something moving westwards.
Ah. Okay, I was just wondering if you needed that to like send, if you were gonna like send guards or something like that.
Oh, I don't have any authority like that. You might want to talk to what's her fucking name again? You might want to talk to one of the guard posts around town. I'm pretty sure I heard Liodel is a very justice-oriented princess that works with the guards recently. However, I don't know where she would be. I can't get in contact with her recently. She may contact me. I do not know. Anyways, I'll try to get in contact with her and let her know. But anyways, that's all I have. If you do this job for me, I will reward you with 1,500 gold. Or I guess a spell scroll of your choice that I can make you.
Oh. Okay.
Or something else you wish, a favor, whatever you want, really. I just need this done before the complete celestial solstice in about 6-ish days.
Alright.
The end of the year is your deadline, and you have to get back to me before then. So, that is your job. Now, I'm not really upset that you're an orc, and I'm thankful for you saving me, apparently. That's why I've even allowed you to meet with me at the moment. I would recommend being careful slaying individuals in a city and then roaring.
Yeah, it's kind of in the moment there.
It's not my place to say. I will say thank you. That is all I will have to say. And, roll me a diplomacy or performance check.
Diplomacy.
Okay.
It's 15.
Okay, and now I need to look at the thing here. Give me 1 second. No, that's not it. That's not it. That's not it. Is it this? Alright. She looks you up and down and goes, maybe get yourself cleaned up too. Oh, I shouldn't be talking. You know what? Sorry, give me a second. She goes, you know what? I did hear there was a good hot spring in town if you wish to get yourself cleaned up. After all, you look like you've pissed yourself in the dungeon. Give me 1 second. And she grabs a small card she has, and she goes, this is a wonderful hot spring. It's called the Sakura's Hot Spring. It's in the Flower District because it's also a part of the branding of the Sakura's Blessing, you know, the brothel. It's not there, and it's not related to it. It's just that it has a relation to it in that it has the same owner. But it is great for the skin, for the muscles, whatnot. It's open until the night comes, and then it becomes a more private business that you can rent out, if you'll catch my drift. So I would recommend going soon if you do not want to be caught up in all that raunchiness. In fact, I may go there myself in a few hours after I talk to a few more individuals. Here you go. Here's your voucher. What did I call it? I called it the Sakura what?
Sakura's Hot Spring?
Yeah, Sakura's Hot Spring. Thank you. She hands you a ticket for the Sakura's Hot Spring and goes, get yourself cleaned up. I'll try to get you a carriage for tomorrow, see if I can get Liette Liodel to go with you.
All right.
Or send some guards with you, at least. If I do, they will meet you in front of your mage's respite in the morning. Actually, I don't know if it will be today or tomorrow, but I'll inform you either way. Anyways,
right.
Get going, have a good day, have a good fun spa trip. I may meet you there in a few hours.
Okay. Alright.
And
so
she goes
before
back,
I
you
go...
see, she puts her goggles on and just goes back to working, ignoring you.
Alright, yeah, so before I go, did I know, I need to ask a question, because you did mention her breasts.
Yes.
Alright, how, what that ass do though?
Make a perception check. What's with all your characters suddenly, like, I suddenly mention it, and then all of your characters get that horny grip.
I mean, what? I already put it in there. Bro, I just put it in there already.
Anyways, so what'd you roll?
An 11.
11?
Yeah.
She's not the fattest, but, like, when she bends over to, like, work on her machines, woo!
Alright.
Like, it's nice and round, I'll say.
Alright.
Curvy body, not thick.
Alright. Yeah, Burbit is going to... to make
especially in those in that tracksuit. Woo!
Anyway, so I'm
hourglass like.
Somewhat.
Well, I do need to go piss. I'm gonna make my way towards there. I'll be back in a moment.
Okay. Let's change over. Shiv, you ready?
Yeah.
So Shiv, as we move in the capital of Tirok, of Tyrellian. Sorry, in the capital of Tyrellian, Tirok, the floating island, supported by the tree as well. The tree of the heavens, basically, is what they call it here, because it's a tree that shoots up past the clouds. As the misty veil of this landscape blocks the midday sun for much of the forest, as the bluffs move up in the western reaches, as the bog sinks wood and rots it, the city itself, as this landscape of magic is very deadly, it's the cities that allow life to prosper here. However, not all the cities here are golden and bright. There is a dark side, black side, to these cities. And as such, there are individuals who thrive in it. As we thrust towards the Flower District, through a small building into an underground pit, we see crowds of people from all over the world, Darath, from the Wastes, from Draconia, we see Dragonborn, we see a few other individuals cheering, wow! We see a bookie going, get your bets in now! Get your bets in now! 5 gold! 5, 5, 5, 7, 7! It's a 5-to-1 bet, boys! We have, coming here! Blah, blah, blah. And we have just a bunch of bookies going around, a bunch of popcorn deliverers going around. We see people watching as this wolf gets gutted and just its head ripped off by an ogre as it roars. Blood streaked claw marks and blade marks across its body. It breathes heavy, and it goes, get your bets in, boys! Get your bets in! We have our next competitor, a champion from the deepest reaches of the bog swamp within Tyrellian. We have Shiv, the tiny orc, versus our own home champion, Ogra, the ogre. And at this point, there's a loud cheering, woo, as a gate opens, and we see this chained-up individual, tiny-looking creature, with a caged helmet on, as this elven individual comes up and goes, all right, Shiv, you know the rules. Win this, and you will get a bit more freedom from us. You have 5 gold to pay off us. This is your last match. If you lose, your debt increases. If you win, you earn your freedom. Do you understand?
He just bites down on the iron helmet.
Good. Get out there, and he unlocks the helmet for you and shoves you out as the portcullis closes. Shiv, as you step into the shaded underground portion of this arena as these magic... Oh, give me a minute. Sorry, my mother called me, but I'm fine now. As you step into this lit-up arena, as these magical spotlights shine upon you, this tinge of green golden light hits you in this dirt-covered floored arena, this iron steel cage above you, a dome. People screaming around you. Describe your character and your entrance, please.
Okay, this is a... strange sight for most people, because he's very obviously a goblin, but he stands about 5 feet tall, almost. Or, no, sorry, not 5 feet tall. He stands a little over 4 feet tall, which is fairly tall for a goblin. And he is just a big ball of muscle. And he wears nothing but some ragged trousers. And noticeably, he doesn't carry any weapons. But he does have a mouthful of hideous teeth that a few of them are chipped. Some of them have fallen out, but you can see new ones growing in. And his face is kind of like around his mouth is ripped up. Kind of looks like he's hurt his own mouth just as much as everything else he's bitten.
All right. So, as you enter into this arena and you see the lights blinding around you, as you hear the shouts of the festival, as time nearly slows in your vision, the bloodlust building up in you, the smell of blood hitting your nose, seeing this wounded individual in front of you before the fight begins. How do you behave? How do you act?
He snarls at the ogre and yells out, "Your blood is going to be thick."
What languages do you speak?
Goblin and common.
That's okay. It. You hear, back from the creature, "Obravun, Eorf." It doesn't seem to understand you. But it, as the crowd looks at this, it raises its arms and just crushes its hands together. Roar! As the rest of the crowd, starts to, "Yah, yah, Ogra, Ogra, Ogra." And you hear him, laughing. Hello?
Hello.
Hello.
Sorry, the music got really quiet for a second. I was like,
Yeah.
Let's see. Its health is... Okay.
Alright. Let me pull up a character
sheet. It is very bloodied, by the way, at the moment.
Alright.
As it laughs, your chains are released. You still have the chained manacles on your arms with a chain that runs back a foot on either arm, as well as your neck collar on. But you are basically free for everything else as your weapons are thrown into the pit in front of you. Are there any preparations you'd like to make for the fight?
He'll pick up a sword and start chewing on it to sharpen his teeth.
I will say, Ruby and Shadowy, you both managed to find your way here if you want to be in the crowd. Do you want to be here, or would you say your characters would not have found this place? Your choice.
Slave-fighting arena?
Yeah. Okay.
I don't think Burbit would be the kind to try to find this, especially considering his job at the moment. He's kind of focused on that.
And Ruby, not you.
Invert definitely would. Right.
Invert.
If only because she despises slavery.
As you sit down and you see this goblin standing in the arena, you hear, "Bets, put your bets in. Last time. Last call. Bets. Who is voting on the tiny orc, Shiv, versus Ogra, the ogre champion? Two champions battling in this arena. Who will win? Who will earn their freedom? Who will die? Do you want to make any bets, Ruby?"
While I do despise slavery, I do not despise banks, so I'll stay. 5 gold on the goblin.
5 gold it is! And he takes the gold from you and he goes, "Alright, bets are done, everybody!" And at this point, he goes, "We will start in a minute's time." And he walks away, and you see some other people going around with this popcorn and other materials that you could eat if you wanted to, or drink. I will say, Ruby, make me a perception check.
Alright, so, gotta move to the roll channel just to roll, so... Ah, level 2, right.
Yeah.
I'm wondering, how much XP do I get from that fight, or are we gonna discuss that later?
We'll discuss that later, because I don't do XP, I just level you up or not.
Ah, okay.
If I feel like your character has gained enough experience, I'll level you up.
15.
You notice a few individuals that look more fancy or noble-like that you saw walking in the noble district watching this fight. But anyways, that's all you see. Actually, no, you do see one individual. You see this elf that's about 7 feet tall with this scarlet red hair that flows down to his mid-back. It seems to be unkempt, very long. He has this beautiful chiseled face. For an elf. High cheekbones and these beautiful amber-colored eyes. He seems to sit there in this flowing clothing that seems to reveal his chest area a little bit. It seems to have these... It almost looks like a dress, but it's not. It's a man's attire. It seems to go down to his legs almost. To his ankles.
Kimono.
Not really. It's more like a toga, but it has two straps instead of one. And he just sits there in this black colored man dress, I guess you could say, sitting there with jewelry on his hands, a piece of a necklace locket on his neck sitting there. And he has a chalice as he sits on a beautifully made throne in the middle of this area. As you see women, elf, human, dark elf, slaves, a few of them with chains on, all seemingly leaning on him. Kissing him, feeling him up, and he is obviously doing some groping at the moment, we'll call it that, as he's feeling them up at the moment, but he seems to be watching the fight intently. And you hear the announcer go, "Well, for this fight we do have a wonderful selection of individuals. And after the fight, we will be holding a slave auction, so if you have money in your pocket, feel free to buy. Anyways."
I will say that I used the kitsune change shape to just...
Go ahead. Hello?
Hello?
Okay. Shiv, were there any preparations? I forget. Sorry.
He's gonna sit there hunched over facing away from the ogre chewing on a sword, and because he's essentially trying to use deception for his initiative, he's gonna pretend like he's not paying attention.
Okay, go ahead and roll a deception check versus the ogre's, he's gonna use his athletics check here, because he's gonna try to, burst at you with a fit of strength to try and get an attack on you.
Okay, so for his initiative then, it is... Or do you want me to roll like a check to see if he can use deception for his initiative first?
No, you can just use your deception. It is, you hear, "Let the fight begin!" And everyone erupts in a roar. Go ahead.
I rolled in a roll 20, but I'll just roll it again.
Yeah, just roll.
It was a 22 in a roll 20, but I'm gonna roll it here. 20.
20, okay. So as the ogre starts to move it doesn't, like, fastly move towards you. It leaps with one stride towards you, but as time seems to slow around you again, you have the initiative. What would you like to do?
Once the ogre is near him, he's just going to turn around and leap at it.
So it's literally maybe a foot off the ground, jumping towards you, about to land, strike down at you with its, I believe it has a, yeah, this one would have a, an ogre-like hook. That it's holding. A hook that seems to be like a meat hook that's rusted.
Essentially, he's going to try and leap between its arms and, like, grapple it by the neck.
This is an ogre.
Yes. I forgot to mention. Yes, he has the feat Titan Wrestler. You can attempt to disarm, grapple, shove, or trip creatures up to 2 sizes larger than you or up to 3 sizes larger than
you.
So
it is
large. Is it huge size?
It's large. Size,
so, so it's 2 sizes larger.
Yes.
So then he can grapple it. With no...
So it's contested athletics, I believe, correct?
Yes.
Okay, athletics. Go ahead and roll.
Sure.
He still rolled shitty. Okay,
16.
So 26.
16. Okay, not successful.
So as you go to try and grab around his neck, you try to, and there's just too much fat, and it seems to be oily and slick from all the blood and grease that he's been eating food off of, and it just you start to slip off of him.
Okay. Wait one sec. I need to see. Grappling is a, is a. I need to see if it says an action. So okay, I was checking to see if a grapple counted as like an attack or just a single action.
Yeah. Well, attacks count as a single action too.
Yeah, but like a Yeah, I don't know. Anyway, he's going to.
Oh, sorry. It's an athletics check versus their fortitude DC, which would be. How do I figure that out?
I'm pretty sure it's fortitude.
Oh, go ahead.
Are you looking at his class DC? Is that what you're?
No,
looking
it's
at?
Not. It's not a class. It's an actual creature.
Oh yeah. Okay.
DC for fortitude.
Yeah. Okay.
So well, I'm assuming it was 10 plus the bonus. But I guess we should check to make sure.
So if it's 10 plus the bonus, it's 21. So you would have failed anyways.
Okay.
All right. Let's do fortitude DC.
It's definitely 10 plus. It's 10 plus like their key attribute and then something else. It's the proficiency with the proficiency.
Yeah, so it's yeah, I think it's definitely you definitely would have failed that still.
Okay.
Yeah, it's definitely higher than 16. But anyways. So as you try to grapple it, you start to slip off and then what do you do?
And then he is going to as he's slipping off, he's going to try and bite at its neck. So
okay, go ahead.
What is my bonus to that? It is a plus a 7. Okay. Fifteen.
You make a 15. Let's see. As you go to bite at him, you bite into his neck, but the fat is just so fat you don't actually push through. It's hard, almost. Well, it's not hard. It's just like a jelly-like substance. As you're trying to bite into him, the fat just jiggles and you can't really get a good grip with your teeth.
Alright. More chewing. All he has a desire to do is chew.
You gonna try to bite again?
Basically, he's just gonna bite down harder. Like, he's not gonna, like, open his mouth again.
Okay.
16.
And you try to bite down harder! The ogre suddenly just pounds his belly out, and the fat just ricochets you off of him onto the ground. You didn't meet his AC. You still didn't bite through, I'll say.
Okay.
Oh, so are we taking into account the multiple attack penalty?
We are.
Yeah. I applied the penalty for the second one.
Did you? Because it's
plus
7.
Yeah.
So re-roll that because you added the wrong modifier.
Well, it'll be lower anyway.
Yeah.
But it's also worth noting, athletics checks like grapple and shove are considered an attack.
Yeah.
I'm so used to seeing that, like done automatically because I play Pathfinder 1E and 1E my 1E character sheet just does all that automatically. Okay. So what?
Yeah, you have to manually select it on the actual.
I don't consider athletics checks like that to grapple and attack, just because it's kind of stupid. So it won't do the multiple modifier thing. I'm not gonna do that.
Oh. Okay. So attack 2. It's a plus 2. Is a plus 7.
Okay, just to make sure. So, yeah, you do get bounced off him onto the ground, landing on your feet. Will that end your turn?
Yes.
He's gonna use his first action to try and mock you. He looks up towards, like, his owner, who goes, "Little! Little!" And he looks up to his owner again. "Freak! Freak!" He doesn't understand common, so he's like trying to understand. I'll say he used, like, two actions for that.
Hearing that, Shiv just starts nodding furiously.
He used two actions to do that. He's gonna use his ogre hook to attack you. Does a 23
hit? Bon Mott.
Does a 23 hit me?
Yes.
Yes, it does.
What does Deadly do?
Well, Deadly basically makes it until your crits are. Yeah, it's a crit ability.
What's a trip do? What?
A trip
It's a different attack thing, though, basically.
Yeah.
Okay. So you suffer 10 points of piercing damage as he hooks into one of your shoulders, pulls you up, and just looks at you in the eyes and licks his lips as he throws you back onto the ground as you bounce back onto your feet.
Ouchie.
Pounds his belly. It's your turn. As he's pounding his belly, blood's flying out of his wounds, by the way.
And are there still weapons on the ground?
The weapons you were handed.
Is there any hand axes?
You would have been handed one hand axe and a sword, yeah.
Okay, then he'll pick up a hand axe off the ground, and that'll be his interaction, I guess. And then, as an action, he will throw that axe. So let me look at... I'm assuming it's this... Honestly, it's probably the same as my... Yeah, actually, it would be the same anyway. It just wouldn't be the same bonus.
So as you rush around him, grabbing the axe, throw it. Go ahead.
Oh, actually, it would just be the exact same as... Okay. Plus 7. Oh, it didn't do the... Hold on.
No, it rolled. No, it didn't.
It didn't, like, actually do it as a command, that's why.
Yeah.
Oh, I put 7 plus 76. Just subtract. I accidentally hit another number.
Yeah, I think a 94 hit. No. So yeah, you hit. As you roll backwards, grabbing the hand axe as you roll, you throw it towards him, and it just hits him. Go ahead and roll damage.
Okay, that was a 25, so I'll just roll. Let's see. Oh. 5 pierce. Or not piercing, because this is my axe. 5 slashing. And then he will move right back up and try and chomp him again.
Okay, how much damage did you do?
It was 5 for the axe.
Okay.
And then it's 2 for his chomp. Alright, failed
so
bite.
So as you go to bite him again, he just looks down at you as you gnaw on his knee and just...
Yeah.
He's gonna make a... Is that your turn?
No. While with his mouth on his knee, he's gonna try and grapple his knee with his mouth.
Okay, go ahead. I'm gonna say it's 17 for the DC, because I know it's higher than 16, but I don't know how high it is.
Let me see what the third... Do you want me to, since this is after attacks, do you want me to apply the...
No.
Okay.
I don't count it as an attack.
It would be minus 10 if it...
So, as you go to try and grab onto his knee, it's just slippery. All parts of his body feel oiled or greased up by, like, the food he's eaten and the wounds he's taken. So you're just, like, touching this sumo wrestler that's been, like, bathing in oil.
Awesome.
As you're trying to grab him, does that end your turn now?
Yes.
He's going to make an attempt to just pick you up by your fucking... the scruff of your neck by making a grapple check at you.
Okay.
So, that's an athletics check for him. What's your fortitude DC?
Let's see, if it was with fortitude, it would be 18.
18? He tries to pick you up, but you're like holding on to his fat, and he's like, and he's gonna try to do it again for a second action. Okay, that definitely beats. It's a natural 19 plus his, like, 12. So, this time, he drops you and then grabs you again, this time by one of your feet, and just dangles you in front of him. He's gonna let go of you as a free action, and then as you're falling, he's gonna make an attack at you. So, his ogre hook, that's 24 to hit.
That hits.
He's gonna deal 8 points of damage to you as he stabs you into the center of the gut and just pulls you to the ground, hitting you.
Unconscious.
As he hits you into the ground and your body goes unconscious, he pulls it up. He roars out. Ding, 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 ding. We have a champion! Ogre! The champion! Ogre of Tirok! Alright, people, collect your winnings, collect your losses. We're about to do the slave trade in a few minutes. And you see, at this point, Ruby, a few mages come rushing into the arena and start to do some healing onto the goblin as a cage is put around his head. and an elven individual walks up to him. Shiv, as you're standing there, the elf looks over to you. Man, and you've won all those fights. Well, looks like your debt's back up again. And I'm not willing to keep you. We're gonna sell you. And he drags you away for a minute. Ruby.
As that happens, I'm thinking of a good fight. I'll get out of here.
You sure you don't want to stay for the slave trade?
Oh no, I am going to see if there's anyone else that I'd get out of here.
Sorry, what?
I'd buy them, then release them. But
okay,
if
so you're gonna
I...
stay, right?
Yes.
Okay. So, you see a bunch of people leaving, because like not everybody's into the slave trade here. Just because it's for the law, it's not against the law, doesn't mean people are into it. So like half the people stay. Not even half the people, like a lot of people stay. The one individual that you do notice that stays is that red-haired individual in like the man dress kind of thing. And all his slaves that he has. He sits there, and as he's sitting there, I will say they are giving free like drinks of wine and food to people who stay, as they are limiting some of the seats and forcing you to come closer. So I will say they do give you some free wine or other drinks if you wish to partake in like talking to people while they're getting the slaves ready to trade. It's kind of like a little get-together kind of thing. Like a banquet, almost, before the trade starts.
Yeah.
Do you want to talk to anybody?
Just gonna stand out of the way and up near sort of edge of the room and wait for people to approach me.
Alright, so I will say this. As people are talking, you see the man with the red hair goes, "Yes, and it seems now that my brother's dead, I need to start making some moves. But, you know, I don't think I'm going to vie for the throne. Just simply put, it's not in my style of living. I'm going to let one of my sisters have it. After all, they are much more adequately prepared to deal with justice. Meanwhile, I'm over here talking with underground fighting rings. That's not a good look for a king, if you understand." And you see the rest of the people are all, like, talking to him. And you hear, he goes, he seems to look at you and he whispers to someone next to him, and that person says something back to him, but you can't tell what they're saying. He goes, "All right," and he starts to walk over to you directly. He goes, "Hello there, are you enjoying the feast?"
It's so.
"Did you enjoy the fight, at least? The champion, Ogre, used to be one of mine. I actually trained him for quite a while. However, it's time for me to let him go. You know, I just had to come see him. Just see how he's grown since then. I've got to say, he's grown very well. So, did you enjoy the fights?"
"Yes, it was rather interesting."
"Oh, don't be coy with me. It's fine. I understand not everybody's into the blood sport of slaves versus slaves. But I got to say, I've noticed you standing here, not talking to anybody, and he leans in very close to you, to your face, and you see his eyes go from a very welcoming, nice guy to a very serious, stern, kind of almost insanity look to you, and he goes, "It's not very pleasing when you make a social interaction-based feast for people, and then there's somebody standing in the corner, not talking to anybody, acting as a, let's just say, anchor, a stone. I would recommend you learn social dialect, or not dialect, how should I say, how to act in social environments a bit better. This is just a little friendly advice, if you understand."
"I'm completely social, it's just that I don't have much in common with anyone."
"Oh, that much is obvious, dear. Anyways," and he looks towards you and he goes, "Hmm," and he, like, slowly grabs towards your chin. Do you allow him to?
No.
As you brush off his hand, he goes, "Oh, well, I mean, it truly is a shame. You are somewhat of a beauty, after all. I'll see you again soon." And he walks away.
Yeah. As he walks away, my eyes are going to quickly flip to Fox, like, and back.
You could tell, now that you heard what he was saying, you get the feeling you know who this man is. He's probably one of the twin younger childs of the throne of Liodel. He is probably one of the princes. Well, the only remaining prince now. And there have been some nasty rumors about him, which you believe to be true at this point. So, as the feast ends, Shiv, what are you doing as you're thrown into a cell and just left to wait there? Given some medical attention, of course.
What is he gonna do? He is going to try and annoy anyone who might be nearby as much as possible by banging his iron helmet on the wall.
Alright. Roll me an annoying check.
What performance?
Either performance or diplomacy, your choice.
Well, I'm better at performance.
I think deception.
No, he's not deceiving anybody. He's trying to be annoying.
No, I'm exactly. I know. I'm doing exactly what I intend. There we go. 19.
19. Okay. You're banging your head against this, and a few guards come up to you. Stop! You've done this every night for the past 15 nights. Every time you fight. What is wrong with you? And they just seem to be screaming at you, so annoyed.
It's stop. Fun.
Do you understand? We want you to stop.
Yeah, I understand.
And then he hits his head on the wall.
You see, the one of them is standing there a little bit peeved off. Is the one who's been saying this to you. Suddenly starts to try and take his key out. And he's starting to take his baton out with his other hand. He takes it, puts the key in the lock, and then turns it and opens. Well, no, he takes his key out, turns the door, opens it, and just hits you once with the baton. On the cage, and it just rings. The whole metal cage rings, almost like a bell, and you fall to the ground for a bit, disoriented for a little bit. You watch as they walk away, and let me just, fucking hell. As they walk away, the guard goes, "Fuck, I needed to do that. Sheesh." And you hear the other one go, "Tom, we've been talking about this. You've been going to therapy. You need to get your anger issues under control, man." "I know, but geesh, that guy, I understand, but listen to me." And he puts his hand on his shoulder. "As your friend, I'm just trying," and they just continue to walk away. Roll me a perception check.
Perception, where? Oh, perception's over there, that's right.
I really just did that. I think I
really just did that. Is... Why?
It's those little things that you had to add in.
Oh, okay, I was wondering why my perception was a +4, but it's because I'm a rogue. I was like, I have a -1 to wisdom. What's going on there? Okay. 22.
So, as you start to regain consciousness, you suddenly notice a small glint on the ground from the torchlight that's a bit away from you at this point. And you realize Tom, in his anger, when he was putting his key away after locking the door, dropped the fucking key outside the cell without realizing it on the dirt floor.
Ooh. Numbskulls.
And he's gonna stand there by the bars for a few seconds, just eyeing the key, looking at it, because it's a pretty shiny thing, and he's a goblin.
Roll me a will save.
Okay.
Just to see how long you stand there staring at the shiny. Okay.
He gets a nat 1.
Close. I rolled a natural 5, so a total of 9.
You stand there staring for a good 10 minutes, and you start to hear, "All right, folks, it'll be a minute or two until we start. Until we have the slaves prepared, please. We're going to be starting the slave selling. But this feast was humbly brought to you by our prince of the kingdom of Tirok. And they say his name, young Sir Leodale. Please, a round of applause, and you hear some clapping, and you hear some guards walking down the hallway in the distance, and you realize the key's still on the ground.
How far is it from the bars?
It's probably at the edge of your fingertips, so you can make a check to try and grab it.
Okay. I will start by just doing that. Acrobatics?
Acrobatics check, slide. Yes.
Okay.
Actually, no, this technically would be a thievery check.
Thievery? Okay. Yeah. Where is my thievery? Oh, same bonus. Awesome. Being a rogue is awesome in Pathfinder because it just makes you good at everything.
Barbarian is fun, too, because you get, like, a lot of things like evasion and shit.
Yes, I can literally charge straight through solid objects with two strides.
13?
Yeah.
You reach, and it... You just hit the edge of the keyring, and it bounces a little bit further than your reach.
Wouldn't he be able to slip, like, his... up to his waist past and try and grab it with his feet?
Then he would be able to fucking get out... Oh, wait, no, you're talking about...
No, your feet my head would get stuck.
Your feet are longer if you want to try to grab with your leg instead, because your leg is longer.
Okay.
Thievery check with
the minus 3. It wouldn't be able to go past
minus 3 to the bonus?
Yeah, so like just because you've already... Okay. Actually, no, the DC will just get higher. So go ahead and roll a thievery check for me. Because you probably used your foot for this multiple times before in the past.
I've probably used my feet for all sorts of things.
The ladies call you the footman.
Oh, wait.
Like
as do the men.
17, but...
17? You try to get it, and it goes a little bit just too far away from you.
Ah.
And he starts...
Yeah, added by 2. Okay, yeah. Sorry, go ahead.
He starts... he's not even trying to be annoying anymore. Out of anger, he starts, like, dragging the helmet across the bars.
So,
wouldn't that hurt you as well?
Yeah.
Oh gosh, so as you like shake on the bars and start to drag the helmet around, you shake backwards 1 second and the entire like set of bars for the cage just falls off on top of you.
Uh-huh.
You take a point of physical damage, so you'll be at like full health, so -1.
Okay. Ouch.
However, You move the bars off of you, and the small area of the bars that you just broke off is now missing. However, you hear down in the distance, did you hear that? What was that? Oh no, let's go check it out. And you hear footsteps starting to approach, maybe a few hundred feet away from you.
This
dimly lit hallway.
He's going to leap out into the hallway and face the direction where the guards are coming from and just scream out,
"Smurf the marrow from your bones,"
and then run the other direction.
Roll me an intimidation check, please.
Okay. 26. Never. So, that's a natural 20.
As you run away, the camera pans a few hundred feet down the hallway to the guards who are like, "What was that?" Running back towards your cell, and then they hear, "I'll slurp the marrow from your bones," from a dark hallway in front of them. And one of them shits their pants and just goes white in the face and just stands there. The other one immediately goes, "Nope," up, and just turns around and starts walking the other direction.
It's never been so easy to escape a prison.
So, as you're starting to run through the hallways of the prison, I would like you to make me a survival check to escape the prison, please. Because I'm assuming that's what you're trying to do.
Yeah, I was going to say... If you're asking for a stealth check, he is not being stealthy. 17. Yeah,
17. You manage to get to a point. You're managing to move through hallways that you've been through before. And you know this door leads to the arena. And you know another door leads to further down outside because you were brought through that door when you were brought down the hallway when you first came here. And you get into the room and you notice a few other individuals standing there, including your own slave tender. And he goes, "All right, we have the deal now. 70% of whatever you make off of Shiv goes to me, correct? All right, good to know. And also, if Shiv is going to give you more trouble, if he tries to escape, just cut his throat, please. He, he's He's more trouble than you'll be able to handle.
He's going to throw his fists up in the air and yell out, I want 100%.
Everyone looks over to you. You were not seen at that point. Everyone looks over to you. Your owner goes, well, he's your problem now, and starts to walk away. And the your new owner goes, you see this fat elven man who has this like almost ogre-like appearance who goes,
hey, what are you doing out of your cell? And he starts to walk over to you. Oh, you're supposed to stay in your cell till we come get you.
Going to sprint towards him and try and leap onto his head.
You do so with ease because he is like 5'4". You okay. Leap on his head. But make me an athletics check, please.
Yeah, I was going to say, I'm going to try and grapple him with me.
What?
Is this in the same room as me?
Athletics. No, you're not here, Ruby. You're still on the outside with everybody else. This is like the gate to the arena with the doors.
I love how I rolled so well in the checks that are like, oh, push the bars so, over.
As
oh,
you go to grapple him, you basically Goomba stomp this motherfucker. And his head basically bends down in his neck. And he just, it pops back. His entire body pops 2 feet off the ground and just hits the ground. Boom. And you literally see birds flying around his head. As he's just rolling around on the ground like a godskin noble.
That's awesome. I'm a goblin. I like blood. I'm going to start bashing his head with my helmet.
So the three guards in the room are going to attack you as soon as you made hands on him.
He's still going to keep bashing him with the helmet.
Okay, go ahead and make me just an athletics check.
Okay.
And I was thinking I was being dumb by roaring at the end of the combat.
They call him shit. Okay.
Okay. You don't even need to roll damage. This man is prone. He is basically stunned. You just hit him 3 times and his head is just gone. Minced meat on the ground.
Okay.
The guards come to hit you with their weapons. So let's see. God damn it, man. Not 5e. What the fuck am I doing? Damn, I didn't realize this was going to be Shiv. I thought he was going to be more put together.
The goblin gladiator slave?
You saw that picture and thought he was going to be normal?
Yes.
No, that's what I made my last goblin for. That's why he was a doctor.
So, they try to hit you with their, what the fuck is a sap? Anyways, they try to hit you with, their...
Like a rock.
Their clubs, basically. As they pull out their, batons and try to hit you. They're gonna have a minus there. Well, I'm just gonna give them disadvantage. So, yep.
The sap
okay,
is
so
like
they
a...
both go to hit you, and, you manage to, like, as they both go to hit your head, just, like, knock you unconscious like they did before, and as they swing on both sides of you, you go down and hit him one last time, and they both just hit each other in the face with their clubs, and they slip on the blood hitting the ground, falling unconscious.
And he's just gonna throw his fists up in the air again and just start screaming. Yeah!
Your previous owner is just in the corner of the room watching, going, well, Shiv, congratulations.
What?
Well, I'm not gonna stop you. I don't give a shit. You think I didn't have a plan coming here? I was going to sell you and steal from their coffers. It's quite a good business, actually. Anyways, get going. I'm gonna have to steal from their vault. Goodbye. And he just walks past you.
And he just shrugs, and then he's gonna go and poke out. He's gonna use his thumbs to poke out the guard's eyes.
Oh my god, bro. Make me a medicine check.
Okay. Medicine? Oh, wow. See, this is why it's so great to be a rogue. I have a +2 to medicine as a fucking goblin. Okay. 12.
12. That's a failure, just so you're aware. If you want to use your hero point, I'll allow you to re-roll it.
Nope.
Okay, so you push through, and you feel the pop of the eyeball, but your hands go too far,
and you poke through their brain with your disgusting crusted fingernails. You break through their skull too with your just the force you're placing on their head, and you're just like, ooh, let me try the other one. Same thing.
Well, that's all right.
Man's just killed probably an entire organization by himself.
probably better for them that way, honestly.
Probably I will better say, than waking up with your eyes. I will eyes say actually out. With the 12 technically, because it's 11 or less to kill both of them, you kill one of them and severely impair the other one.
Nice. And then he's just going to like walk out of there. He's not gonna bother with the helmet.
Alright. So you managed to find your way out. And I'll say, because you're not a fucking retard, you realize you probably shouldn't walk out to the normal pathway where all the people who are looking to buy slaves go. So you sneak out a back way. Is that fair to say?
Yeah.
Okay. So, as you sneak out a back way, it does lead out of a sewer and you manage to push out. At this point, it's about nighttime. And we're going to say this, shadowy. As you're, you went to the spot, correct?
Yeah, I went to the Sakura Hot Springs.
All right. So, well, it's not going to be nighttime for you, Shiv, actually. It's going to be around
I just got my wounds sunset. Patched up, yeah. Then I went to the hot springs to relax, hopefully.
So, as you're relaxing there and sunset's coming up, you eventually do talk with, Oyez, as she's finished her hot spring time, too. Actually, hold up. Let's go back here. I was trying to get you two to meet each other, but I don't want to do that just yet. So, Shadowy, as you get yourself patched up and head to the hot springs, it's this nice, beautiful, it looks like a Japanese hot spring. You walk in, there's an entryway with, like, some couches and whatnot. There was some, milk fridges, and then there's, two hallways that lead back to a woman and male, separated bathing place. As you walk in, this old, elf gentleman goes, hello, the fee for the hot spring is going to be, 2 silver, unless you have a ticket.
All right, so I pull out the ticket, and here you go.
Thank you. You're going to be using, you are a man, correct?
Yeah, actually, wait. Burbit takes a moment to look into his pants.
I think
that's right. Yeah, I think a dude would be the best option.
Alright, well, you're going to go into the male baths. You're going to shower before you get into the actual baths. And then, once you're done, we recommend you drink some milk, but you don't need to.
Alright.
We also do have a shared bath, where it's a mixed bath between the men and women, but not a lot of people use that, because, you know, you don't want to have
an incident?
Yes. So, it is very closely monitored, we will say.
Ah.
And he stares at you as if you're a criminal.
Alright, yeah, Burma's gonna ignore that and quickly get to the shower area.
Alright, so, as you're beginning to shower, you're starting to think back to the events of the day and how, hey, at least you didn't get killed today.
Hey, I did something heroic and I didn't die. Things are doing pretty good.
Meanwhile, Shiv, as you're pushing through, you see a grate that opens up above you into a lit room. There's water pouring down above you.
Alright. Well, he's gonna, even if this is, like, dirty bathwater, he's gonna let it run over his face and drink a little bit of it, and then climb out.
So, you make me an acrobatics check, because there's no real, like, ladder to climb out here.
Okay.
Alright, yeah, you just jump from wall to wall on this pipe. Shadowy, you hear something beneath, like the clanging of metal, clung, 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 and you turn around for a second and you see the drain in the middle of the room suddenly clung, clung, hit the ground on the opposite side. And you see climbing out this goblinoid figure that then just pulls the grate back over, closes it, and looks around.
And he's covered in blood and dirt.
Alright, so, Burbit looks at him a bit concerned. Eh?
Aye.
Alright. You look up pretty dirty. Do you want to try using this?
He looks down at himself and, like, scrapes some of the dirt off of his skin. Puts it in his mouth and tastes it for a second.
Nah.
It's not dirt. It's shit.
Still. He looks at him and he's like, nah.
Ah, that's right. That's the day I had chocolate. 2 weeks ago, actually. Anyways. So, this goblin man just climbs out of a sewer. You say, hey, do you want to use some soap and water? And he's like, nah.
Alright. I guess, sorry. I think this is kind of an awkward introduction. The name's Burbit.
I'm Sheep.
Is that a nickname, or...?
Shadowy, it's at this point that you notice this Shiv has manacles with chains that follow behind him for about an inch on each of his wrists, and a collar with a gem a collar with a gem in the center of it on his neck, and then a cage helmet on. That's very bent in the front for some reason.
Okay, I assume, yeah, slavery's common enough, so I'd probably at least know that that's a slave. Yeah.
Yeah.
Like, oh. Burbit, realizing this, is like, he's like, he isn't going to comment immediately.
Why are you looking at me like that?
Oh, you seem to be a slave. I guess I didn't really want to mention it.
Oh, well, I'm not one anymore. I'm not in the prison.
All right. I'd advise you avoid the people who I assume are looking for you at this point in time.
They did.
You're probably going to be one again.
I killed them.
All right. I would advise against going out the front door. There's someone in there.
You think they'll stop me? And he just smiles.
I'd say you probably shouldn't kill people. That's going to get a lot more negative attention. And it's also wrong.
I didn't say that. I just asked if he'd stop me.
Oh, he'd probably at least call the guards, even if he didn't stop you. And so they'd probably have an easier time finding you.
Eh.
Burbit's just going to finish up showering while this is going on, because Shiv isn't exactly taking the offer.
Alright.
He's gonna look around the room some more and... he might just wander into one of the bath areas. Doesn't really matter which one it is to him.
Alright, you climb into one of the baths and it feels great. It's like a nice 80 degree bath.
Yeah, he's not doing this to get clean. That's why the bath was okay and the shower was not. He just wants to go for a swim.
I see.
Right. So, Burbit, after getting a shower, is gonna head into the male bath.
Alright, you climb into the same bath that Shiv's in, because that's the only bath in the area.
Yeah.
It is a large bath that's in the ground. It's like a reservoir, basically. As you climb in, you see a few other individuals that are in the bath who have just been watching this encounter. And they're just looking around and like, what? And they just don't seem to give a fuck. Elven individuals.
There's also blood and shit just washing off into the
As soon
bath.
As they see that, they're going to step out of the bath.
Yeah, so Burbit, seeing that, is going to try going on the opposite side to soak a little bit.
Okay.
I might have to take a shower before I leave here. But,
yeah, all right. he's swimming. He's not sitting in one spot.
So Shiv, I guess so while we're here,
he's just swimming
really
circles in the middle of the pool.
Don't we have much else to talk about? I guess how has your life been up to this point? I'm just one, or at least where you came from.
I don't remember what it's called.
Over the ocean. Did you take a couple? Did you take a couple hits in the head during a fight or something?
No.
Maybe. I also hit my own head sometimes. Hit.
Okay, that probably explains that a bit. I guess if you can't remember much, I think I should try telling you. I mean, it would be a bit rude for me to just ask you that. I come from a place in the raft called the Mithril Docks. I was working for my dad's fishing company. I came here when I heard of I saw a little flyer by an elven lady named Oyezir. Apparently she's a court mage in this city. So, I'm gonna be going on a job there. Yeah, we're going on a job to a place named Oakage. I would invite you, but there might be one of the princesses of this country might be going on that mission because I told them about a bandit attack. So I'm not sure how well you going on it would be.
I like princesses.
I guess I would advise that you go get there some other way because you're probably gonna draw attention if you try riding with the princess. Yeah, sorry, the princess. Oh god, the smell's getting a bit bad. All right, that's a bit better. So, yeah, I guess that's kind of the explanation of why I'm here.
At this point, the entire pool is starting to turn a murky reddish brown.
I think it's the time to get out. All right, I'm gonna.
Yeah, it's not hot enough.
He'll just climb out, and he, shakes himself off.
Yeah, alright. So, as you take another shower, Shadowy, and leave the room, does Shiv follow?
Yeah.
Alright. Shiv follows, and as you guys walk back down the hallway, you guys get out to the, entrance room, and you see them, Shadowy. You see Oyez, who seems to have finished their bathing as well. And they come out, and they seem to go over to one of the fridges, throw a copper, two copper pieces over to the, person who's, working the, can't think of the fucking word right now, counter, and goes, I'm gonna take one of these, and, she takes a, glass of milk and starts to drink it. She sees you and goes, oh, hello there again.
Oh, hey, oh yes.
Who is this that's shaking your leg with a homemade knife?
His name is appropriately Shiv. He kind of disappeared from the drain. He just crawled out of it.
There's a lot of shiny things down there.
I see. Well, I wanted to have a talk with you about your mission, but it seems you're a little busy with your friends at the moment. So I will just be over there, and I will be going soon. Goodbye. And she walks away.
Alright.
Shiv looks up at him.
She giving you some of those shiny things for the mission?
Well, yeah, she's actually going to pay me if I finish the mission up. I think she was going to give me some info, but... I'm not sure if it's, you know... If it might be some racism? Or at the very least... Oh, then again, to be fair, she also might just be concerned about security.
What's that?
Imagine you just get out of a bath.
I mean, yeah, that's the thing. I'm just thinking.
Somebody who's already not liked favorably by the people who just randomly saved you, and asked you to pay them for a job, and you're like, okay, yeah, I'll trust this person. They saved me. And then you give them a free ticket to a bath. They come out. You decide to talk to them more about the job, to tell them more information that you've just come across. And you see a tiny, dirt-covered, goblinoid man with a cage on his head, who seems to be a slave, stabbing at the fucking ankle of this guy that you're supposed to talk to. I don't think you're going to want to approach him at that moment.
That's what I was also going to say. It's like, or it also might be here because you're kind of weird. I'm not sure if it might be a combination of those things.
No, I don't know.
No, I think she was too nervous. I think she likes my dent, and he just rubs the dent in his cage.
Probably that is kind of what he would. That is basically the kind of thing he would say.
You know, it's probably the latter.
I fucking love Shiv, man. I can't wait for him to meet Gordon Freeman.
As our loss.
Alright, Shiv, I guess with that interaction, I guess we do know a bit about the job, so, I guess considering your situation, do you just want to try helping me out? I've heard that since there's probably going to be bandits attacking the place, it could be dangerous. I could use some backup.
Awesome.
Alright,
Blood and Shinies? Nice.
Alright, so Shiv, I'm not sure where to bring you, because I'm guessing if we just walked out with you, the guards would be trying to get you, and possibly me, for being around with you. I'm not sure about that. So, I think I'd advise that you go off on your own for now. Do you think we should try meet? Do you want to try meeting up back here? Back here tomorrow?
Alright.
Alright. Yeah. Good luck with whatever you're doing. I hope things go well.
Eh. They usually do.
So.
Somehow.
As Shiv walks out of the establishment, I would assume, correct? Or does he want to do something else here?
No, he's just going to stroll out like nothing's weird about him at all.
Okay. Just make me a performance check.
All right. Funny enough, he actually, having the gladiator background means he's allowed to use performance.
God damn it. 13. Why do I have two gladiators in the group?
No clue.
Anyways, what'd you roll?
13.
All right. As you're walking around the streets, walking out, nobody's going to stop you when you look like that. There's, of course, some people who just watch you as you go by. I'll say you eventually find a resting... Where do you find to sleep for the night?
Where does he find to sleep for the night? That's a good question.
A dumpster?
I was going to say, are there any, like... what's the word I'm looking for?
Brothels?
Fuck, no. Compost. Are there any, like, compost piles?
There would
like,
not be.
Rotting plants?
Not really. But there is, okay. If you want, you could go to the fucking royal gardens outside the palace.
Yeah. That sounds like a good idea. He's gonna find a little flower bed and sort of, you know, move some of those flowers out of the way. Nice comfy spot in the dirt.
Sure. Okay. That's where you fall asleep for the night.
Yeah.
Alright. Ruby, let's get back to you really quickly. You wait and wait for the slaves to be brought out, and they are brought out, and over the course of the day, the rest of the slave auction, of course the prince buys a few more slaves that are more beautiful than anything else. He buys a few big-titted elven slaves and whatnot. And you're waiting for the goblin to come out just to see what happens to him, yet the goblin never shows up, and they go, "Well, folks, it seems the slave auction is over. It seems a few of our slaves escaped. This will be rectified, and at our next auction, we will hopefully have them to sell there as a rarer commodity."
Commodity.
That's the word I'm looking for. Thank you, random audience member. And you see the rest of the people start to leave, and the prince just stares at you. What are you doing, Ruby? Are you leaving too?
Yeah, I'll leave.
He just stares at you as you leave, and you see him whisper something to it over his shoulder. And you swear you see a flicker in the air, but nothing else. Anyways, so you head back to your room, I assume, correct? Or what are you doing?
Yeah, taking a walk through the merchant district to see if there's anything that really would interest me.
Well, at this point, it would be getting towards nighttime. So as you stroll through, because you're in the flower district at the moment, you see a few brothels are opening, a few bars, dive bars, late night establishments, other places are closing down. What are you interested in?
Something more towards the magic of divination, such as fortune telling or things like that.
I was just about to say, there is a fortune teller's tent that you see.
I'll approach the tent.
Alright. You see an individual walk out, throw the curtain away, and go, "Bullshit! You're a fucking liar! Fuck you!" And he walks away and he goes, "Ain't no way I'm gonna have that bad of luck." And he trips on a rock and hits his head on the ground, passing out.
Nothing changed.
I couldn't even hear you there, man.
I said, never underestimate the power of fortune telling. It can often mean the change between life and death. I admire that under my breath as I enter the tent.
As you enter the tent, there's this nice, beautiful, perfumey mist smell that hits you. As it does, you blink your eyes, and the tent looks a bit bigger on the inside than it should be. As you see this widespread carpet on the ground of blackish purple color, you see there's no real candles or anything lit in here, and the tent inside is this black velvet that looks like stars blinking. You look over to your left and you just see there like the glow in the dark stars that you put on your ceiling. As you continue forward, you see this just empty tent, and as you're looking around wondering where's the person, suddenly you hear, "Another has come, seeking fortunes, seeking wisdom. Now they seek to know their future. Or do they seek something more?" As you hear these three voices all talking at once. And suddenly, the room starts to spin and spiral. I want you to make me a will saving throw, please.
Alright. As it does happen, I'll say, I've come because I find that the fortunes told by others are more accurate than you telling your own. Dirty 20.
As the room starts to spin, you hear, "Fortunes told. Ooh, interesting. The Fox of Fortune seeks their own from another." At this point, you look towards the center of the room, and the floor almost rises as this felt-like carpet seems to push up, and this round table appears. The mist grows deeper, deeper, and you can't really see, and suddenly three shapes of humanoid figures start to dance and meld in the distance around this table. And then this light in the middle of the table starts to glow, and the three shadows conjoin into one. The mist starts to settle down, and you see, sitting in a chair across from you, with a crystal ball in the center of the table that is giving off a grayish-blue light to the room, a single hooded figure with this flowing blonde scraggly hair coming out of the hood itself, covering any facial features you could see besides a single dark strand missing on the left side of their face. You hear,
"Sit, Fox of Fortune. Have your palms read. Have your future known. Have your luck bestowed to you. What is it you seek?"
As they seem to turn their head towards you upwards, and in that single slit in their hair, you just see this yellow pupilless eye staring at you from a dark expanse behind. As these crony-like long fingers bony and protruding in multiple places. You see multiple, as they seem to, multiple joints as they seem to bend their fingers, five joints as it starts to spindle like a sphere onto itself, like a wheel. And they seem to relax their fingers outwards once more, and they go, "Sit!" as a chair suddenly appears behind you, knocks you onto it, and whoosh, pushes you up to the table.
"So, what is it you seek?"
"Hello?"
"I wish to know how me and my acquaintances shall fare on this quest we're going on soon."
"Visions of the future. Interesting. The divine eye sees all. But does the tongue tell?"
And you see her start to move her hands around the ball. As she does, she starts to speak some incantations. What languages do you speak?
I speak... Hold on, let me check. Common, Elven, and Kitsune.
Okay. You hear a language you don't know. Sounds like a dark choir. Mixing in with fog. And as they start to incantate, they start to move their hands, and their fingers start to bend around, forming this lattice around the crystal ball, not touching the ball itself, and moving. And you don't know how their hands are moving like that. It's like their wrists aren't attached to their arms. And you look, and there's no one in front of you. Everything around you, the tent is gone. All you see is the table, the crystal ball, and this finger-like lattice surrounding the crystal ball as the table drops away from it. Everything around you is dark. You're sitting on the chair only. Everything turns to starlight around you, and all you see is this ball in front of you, and this one yellow glaring pupilless eye on the other side of the ball. Now let's see. Fuck, okay.
"My, oh my, what a future you hold. For a fox like you."
Sorry, give me a second. I'm trying to remember what I was about to say.
"For a fox like you, an adventure very bold. To the west, we see your fortunes you find. For humans and elves, not many your kind.
Give me a second. I'm trying to remember the rest of this here. I'm trying to figure out a rhyme that rhymes with what I have in my head right now. Give me just 1 second. Okay, yeah.
"A maiden of light, holy and pure. Disease and plague, they will find cure. In the hills and bluffs, a steel unleashed. Past evil found. And a friend shall keep." "Poisons and danger found and found many."
I'm trying to figure out a word that rhymes with many here, so give me 1 minute. Yeah, okay.
"A prophet once hidden. Name of Denny. Long lost knowledge you will find hidden. Your fate unwoven. Future to be bidden. In a small village.
At this point, the lattice of fingers breaks, and you see the crystal ball shatters, and the room is just complete pitch blackness. And you're standing in an empty alleyway, the tent long gone, not existing there. The alleyway is where the tent was, by the way.
Yeah, I know. I'd hum thought, then head on my way, contemplating the prophecy as I head back to my room. Also, can you send that prophecy to me in DMs?
I don't remember it, so I'll clip it on the YouTube and just fucking send you a clip of it.
Okay. So,
yeah. As you begin to leave the alley, you swear you see that same yellow pupilless eye staring at you from deeper in the alley, and you hear, and it disappears as you make your way back to your room. Now, Shadowy. Shiv has left the establishment. Shadowy?
Yep, I hear ya.
Shiv's left the establishment, and you see over in the corner, getting ready to leave, Oyez is brushing herself off a little bit, and she looks towards you and starts to walk towards you and hands you a letter really quickly. She goes, "This will procure you a room with Lieta over in the Mage's Respite for a night or two until I get some carts ready for you, of course. I apologize, it's not going to be one of the fancier ones. I don't get paid a lot. I just get paid for my knowledge and help. So, make your way there. That is where you'll be staying for the night, or tomorrow night as well. I need to get going. It was great to see you again. Is there any other questions you have for me before I go? Anything you want to talk about, either?
I guess if you don't know that yet. I can get there's one thing. What would you say about getting extra help on this mission? Like, let's say, like some, like a mercenary or two?
That's what I've been asking the guards about, to get some guards possibly to help as well. I believe there was an individual that came to me. I can't remember who they are. I'll let you know. She wouldn't say that. She would say, I believe there was an individual that came asking about the quest earlier, but I can't remember who they are for right now. I can't remember what we talked about too much. I hit my head pretty badly. So, memory's kind of foggy. I'll let you know more details once I get back to my lab, since, you know, that's where my memory seems to jog up more when I'm there. Anyways, it was great seeing you. I hope you enjoyed your bath. And she puts her hand on your shoulder. You have a wonderful night, okay? And make sure to stay safe. You are working for me. I do not like my people dying on me. Make me a will save, please.
Uh-oh, spaghetti, yo. Yes, a will. That should be. Yep, that should be a plus 5 to make sure. Yep, there we go. Yeah, there we go. Bop. Alright, that's an 11.
As she touches you and begins to leave, and as you're watching her walk away, you're like, holy shit. Like, you look down and you are rock hard at that moment. You realize that, like, in that moment, you looked at her, and her skin was glistening after the bath. Her pores were nice and cleared. Her hair was flowing down and beautiful, different than when she's, like, covered in grease and whatnot. And you're like, oh, God, what was that? and you had to carefully hide yourself with a towel really quickly.
Had to pull up oil.
What?
You had to pull up the towel, you know, just adjust it a little, you know?
Yeah. But yeah, you're in your clothes, you're not in a towel right now, because you're in the front room, you had to put your clothes back on, but yeah. Yeah, she is a very beautiful lady, and you got aroused looking at her after she touched you. But
She leaves the room and goes back to doing what she's doing. What are you doing?
Alright, considering it is approaching nighttime, it would likely be...
it is nighttime at this point.
In that case, it is nighttime, so it is most pertinent for me to turn this voucher in and get some rest, as I am likely to need it for tomorrow.
Okay. So, as you make it back to the mage's respite, you have your encounter with Ruby that you had before, where you talk about the job. You have your encounter with the monkey who steals your money. And you awaken the next day with the scream below you. As you rush out of your room to see what that was, you start to walk down the stairs and you see Bill, the half, well, not the half orc, the full orcish Greek looking man, is already there at the door to the scream room and opens it. And he seems to talk inside. He goes, "Oh, well, keep it down, you two." And you hear, "That's not what this is about. That's not what this is about. Stop copying me." And he goes, "Okay." And he closes the door and locks it and walks downstairs. He goes, "It's okay, everyone. Just seems to be a lover's quarrel." And he continues downstairs.
Urban's gonna make sure he has everything on, you know, his breastplate, sword, and all that. He's gonna just get that ready, because he doesn't, just in case something screwy happens.
Alright, at this point, Ruby's character comes walking down the stairs, too.
Alright.
What was that scream? I'd ask.
Apparently a lover's quarrel.
Well, we should probably head to breakfast. As she continues down.
Yeah.
Okay, as you guys continue down. You see, at the bottom of the stairs, as you enter in, you see this beautiful elven woman with blonde hair that seems to be pulled up into a braided bun. This beautiful count's attire, similar to the Walcott picture I mentioned. It seems to be buckled over coat that has it's the little like pins you put to pin like extra sleeve area down backwards. What are they called? Capulets or something like that for your sleeves. I'll just call them caps.
Caplets.
Yeah, caplets. They have caps that seem to be bending the extra bit of the sleeve backwards on this green jacket. They have white gloves on. They have these white slacks and these black boots that come up to their mid foreleg. I can't fucking tibia. I don't know. Whatever it's fucking called, man. I'm tired.
The front half of your upper or lower leg?
Lower leg.
That would be the shin.
The shin, yes. There you go. That was the word I was looking for. Thank you. Goes halfway up their shin, and they seem to be sitting there, tapping their finger, looking around. This elven woman with very, like, if you pulled Play-Doh forward and backwards kind of angled face. Beautiful still in nature, and she's just tapping, waiting. And you see at this point, an individual, a dwarven man, comes walking down the stairs, wielding a crowbar made of wood, and sits down next to her, and she starts to get mad at him and goes, "You were supposed to be up 4 hours ago, and you and your friend and I were supposed to leave. Luckily, the other two that we were talking about weren't prepared either, so... they haven't met me yet, so you're fine for now." He goes, he starts to talk to her, and he walks over to the bar for a second. At this point, the woman looks over to you two and goes, she just throws her hands up and looks at you with a face of, "Are you kidding me?" And she starts to walk up to you and goes, "Finally, you two are awake. Jesus, they were supposed to be ready 4 hours ago. Why are you late?"
I do question, what time is it at the moment?
At the moment in time, it would be about 8 o'clock in the morning. 8 to 10. And she goes, "We're supposed to meet at dawn. Did you not receive that information or something?"
I guess I didn't exactly receive at dawn.
Fucking oh yes. Anyways, good to see that you're here. The others seem to not be prepared just yet, so we will wait for them. Go ahead and get to the carriages outside in the front. You can meet the others soon.
And we had that tiny goblin, or that large goblin, I should say, that we found in the palace gardens, who said he was joining us on this quest or something, mentioned you two specifically. We have him in the carriages as well. However, we have him in a small cage because he was trying to gnaw at the guards' helmets and swords. So we couldn't really keep him anywhere else.
Understandable.
Yes. Anyways, we'll be heading to Oakage. It'll be about a half a day's journey since we're using our carriages. We have two of them. Anyways, I need to go speak with the others again. And she walks off to go speak with the dwarf once more.
Alright. So with that, Burbit set is going to try to at least stay around here to not complicate matters too much further, you know?
Yeah. So as Burbit walks outside, you see the two carriages, and you see affixed to the back, hanging by a chain, a cage with a very angry goblin in it. Shiv, you're in a cage, hanging off the back of a cart.
Why'd you put me in here?
The guard looks at you. You're trying to steal my helmet and sword to gnaw on for the fifth time. Do you have brain damage or something?
I need it to sharpen my teeth.
You're lucky we took that cage helmet off of you.
Oh, I would have got it off my own. You saw it.
I mean, it was kind of funny to track you down like a dog when you kind of like got caught in like the net when we were chasing you through the garden. That was kind of funny.
Yeah.
Got you there, didn't I?
Yeah.
Anyways,
I'll remember that, though. Just kidding. Or am I?
You see his face go a little bit pale and goes, yeah, good one. And he walks away. You manage to steal his dagger off him.
He's just gonna chew on that.
Alright.
Does my pocket monkey do anything? I'd assume probably, since
you already scolded your pocket monkey today.
Today? In the morning?
Yeah, in character. Remember, you're like, you shouldn't steal from a party members.
Oh, wait, did...
No, that was last night.
Oh, yeah, that was the night before. Never mind. Yeah, the pocket monkey's still awake. Let me roll to see if it steals. Okay, yeah, it steals. See if it makes a thievery check properly, though. Fuck, why does it make it so high? God damn it, I even rolled to see what it stole off the princess. Okay.
Her virginity?
No.
Invert, did you give me the gold back?
Yes.
It was an exchange, yeah. Alright.
So, as you're walking out, and you see Shiv, the three of you, well, the two of you reconvene, and Ruby, you meet the goblin for the first time. If you would like to describe your characters to each other.
Yes. I am wearing a dark forest green cloak with a blue and gold kimono underneath. Wearing traveling sandals that are dark blue with bright pink hair, amber eyes, well, bubblegum pink hair. The ears and my tail are also pink with the hood up. Though you would not be able to see the ears or tail.
And for you, you see a 4 foot tall orc, so basically a tiny green man in this cage just chewing on a dagger with his big old teeth. His ears are kind of shredded up, looks like they've probably been nicked by all manner of weapons and bites. And he wears nothing but some burlap trousers with some leather padding on them.
This is the man that escaped about a day or two ago, Ruby.
Yes, I did notice.
Yes. So go ahead and roleplay now if you want.
I remember. Also, I'm 5'2".
It's funny that all these people are just, like, short, and I happen to be the tall goblin. I keep interacting with people who are barely taller than me.
I think mine's actually on the lower end of the scale.
Yeah.
So, what happened after you made your escape last night?
Well, it was 2 nights ago again.
Oh, chicken legs ago.
Well, I went through the sewers and then...
Doesn't even question how I know.
Swimming, and then...
I made a pretty lady, she liked my dent. He rubs his one single hair on his head.
Yeah, the princess liked my helmet. It's gone, though. They took it. And,
Shit.
Oh, I slept in... I slept in the forest. There was a lot of flowers for some reason. I had to move them out of the way. Not comfortable to sleep on. And they smell weird.
You do idly notice that she does have knuckle dusters on.
you looking to find someone?
This
is just in case we come across any troubles in our travels. As you also notice the absolute arsenal she has on her. A dang bastard sword, a falchion, a warhammer, and a scythe.
And then he sort of just tosses the dagger out of his cage, like, onto the floor, and just grins and bares his teeth and is like,
yeah, I got all I need, Roddy.
The dagger is chewed up heavily, like, not like... It's strange, because a dagger usually breaks, but this is, like, chewed, like, it looks like a chocolate bar or a plastic toy that's been chewed by a dog.
This is all I need. My daddy gave them to me.
At this point, as you guys make your way into the carriages to get
yourself... Yeah, Burma's just looking at this conversation, like, just going, all right.
So as you make yourself comfortable in the carriages and start to, like, find your way in the carriages really quickly, there's some alcohol if you wanted it, except for Shiv, because he's on the outside cage.
Also, Invert is slightly... Sorry, go on.
They throw you the occasional, like, meat scrap, by the way, Shiv, if you want it. Anyways, go ahead, Ruby.
Yeah, Invert is slightly surprised that neither of them questioned how she knew about Shiv's escape.
Anyways, so as you guys are getting ready to leave or whatnot, you see a very nervous and, like, alert guard leading this very beautiful elven. Actually, let me get the description I have for her. Leading an elven lady out of the inn that you guys just came out of. You see a 5'10" female elf with snow white skin. And a very strange piece of attire on. She's wearing this jacket that seems to be made of just black felt or something. And it says, it has some strange words on it. And I think the only one that... Do any of you guys speak Abyssal?
No.
Okay. Good, no. Because it's common. It says Supreme multiple times on it, which is a weird fashion sense.
Oh, no. Oh, no.
She's sporting scarlet red hair that seems to fall down to her lower back hips. And she seems to be very peeved at the moment. Yeah.
I assume I don't notice my pocket monkey near me.
Nope. Your pocket monkey does run back up to you at the moment. And as he does, he gets over to you, and he just pulls off of his small little bandolier piece of rope he has what seems to be a coin purse.
Do you take this from that lady over there as they point towards the princess?
It shakes his head. Okay, so are you talking about the one that's walking out of the bar, or are you talking about the princess that you already met once?
Because
the scarlet-haired lady is walking away at the moment. She's not coming to you guys.
The annoyed one.
Okay, yeah. He shakes his head no.
Very well. I said just tie it next to my other one.
Okay. Go ahead and add 137 gold to your inventory.
Okay.
Bruh.
You see, walking out of the establishment, this pair of individuals. You see the princess you've met already, Liette Liodel, the first princess with the golden hair, who comes walking out, and she seems to be talking. She goes, they're a little bit more, they're already ready, unlike you. And you see this, human man with a cowboy hat who seems a little frazzled, walking out. She goes, they were here before you were, and that's something to say since you literally apparently weren't in the place you said you were. Anyways, go introduce yourself to your friends over there, I guess. Your new compliance. And she, the princess you met seems a little bit more annoyed, and she keeps going, where the fuck did I leave my coin purse? Fuck. And she walks back into the inn for a minute.
So I hear that, and I'm thinking, I think. Herbert hears that, and he kind of looks over to Invert like, what? Like, really?
I give my pocket monkey a pointed look.
He looks up at you and smiles. You see the human man start to approach you, and he goes, all right there. He looks frazzled, and the first thing you guys notice is the man looks like a cowboy. He looks like Arthur Morgan, basically. That's what I was told to introduce him to look like.
Hey.
however, the main thing you notice that's different about like his actual aesthetic is that he has a large kiss mark on his right cheek. And you can see he's trying to wipe it away, but it's not coming off. Lipstick just stuck to his cheek. He goes, a bit, yeah. And he goes, excuse me. He walks into a different carriage than you guys and just sits down. Ruby, roll me just a religion, perception, or arcana check. Your choice.
Religion, perception, or arcana. I have best for perception.
Okay.
Let us see. Dirty 20.
That's enough. That was actually the DC. Fuck you. You recognize the smell that you smell off of him and the certain areas of his body that seems to be having this strange shift. The smell, you recognize it as the smell of a marked man by another kitsune. And the reason you do is because your mother marked your father and it smells horrible to other kitsune to try and deter them from taking their apparent mate.
I assume this is the man that I met at the gate?
This is the man...
Called Morgan?
No, this is not Morgan. This is the man you met at the museum, actually, now that you're thinking back. the one who was turning in that body. As you all sit down, the princess goes, ah, fuck it. I'll just have to get fucking more money, I guess. Jesus. Didn't want to go to that bank. I fucking hate those people.
I will approach her and say, excuse me.
Yes, hello. What can I do for you?
My monkey here I had heard you lost your coin purse, and my monkey here, my monkey companion here, has found it. As I would return it.
Roll me a deception check as you show your monkey.
Oh, no.
All right, there we go.
Uh-oh. Oh, no.
15. Does that fail?
It does.
I will use Prophecy Pawn.
Okay.
Uh-oh.
Actually, no, I'll use my Hero Point.
Okay, go ahead and use your Hero Point
first. Uh-oh, Spaghetti-o.
21.
21. That fails. Yeah, she rolled natural 20 plus 5 minus 2. She's at 23.
Oh.
This is a certified bra moment.
She looks at you and goes, I don't want to start any fights right now before we serve justice to the bandits that attacked Oakage.
but you and I will be having a lengthy discussion about your monkey's thieving hands when we return, or once we finish the bandits off. Understood?
Yes, ma'am. I have not been able to break this habit of his as I have recently acquired him.
Anyways, we'll talk about this later. I'm surprised to see that everyone was late. Well, sorry, no, that's not what she says. She says, all right, now that everyone's here, we can get going. I'm surprised to see that you're all up early in the morning. I'm just fucking with you. You're supposed to be here. No, I'm not. She's not an asshole like that. She was going to be a really big asshole just now. But no, she's not like that.
I wanted
that.
Her to be. Because...
She looks over to the goblin and she goes, well, I'm surprised we have a goblin with us. But, you know, the more the merry, I guess. Blah, 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 blah. Whatever. Let's get going. This group is really pissing me off right now. And she jumps in a cart. the cart with the human in it. And as you guys begin to take off through the streets, through the gates, and down to the forest, traveling half a day's journey, you begin to make your way towards the village of Oakage. As the sun begins to find its way halfway into the sky, and you begin to approach the bluffs that surround the ditch or crater of Oakage, as the tree forms this dome-like canopy above, as there are no trees within the ditch that exists Oakage. As you see the long burnt and destroyed parts of a village in the distance, as plumes of smoke begin to rise. And you see Zeus's character, the human, look out of the carriage that he's in and wave his hat and say, I brought the cavalry! To the rest of the people, who you can see a group of individuals grouping up and looking over towards where you approach the village from. Now, I will, when we do, I will ask that if you are going to do some roleplay, do it in your private DMs with the other players that are in the group at the moment. The only players that you cannot really roleplay with are going to be Soup's character and Keegan's character, just because they're not with your group. If you want to do some roleplay with the other members of your party, feel free. Just let me know if there's any, like, major developments that I need to know about. Anyways,
you're right.
As the carts enter into the Oakage area, that's where we're going to end the session. Alright.
Yeah, well, right.
I'm going to stop the recording now because it's been going for 3 hours and 22 minutes.